call the Board of Selectmen together and into business here on 6/21/16. Caitlin tells me the bells have rung for 7 o'clock, so it must be time. Let's start off with Selectmen's liaison reports. Mr. Arena.
Nothing to report. I was witness to the accident last night and the great job that Reading Fire and Police did in negotiating traffic from all directions with not a lot of warning. So that's a tough intersection with folks coming down 28 and driving business on Pearl Street and Haverhill Street. But everything looked like it was well managed. So thank you, Chief, and thank you to the teams. And thank you, Chief Burns. I know you're not here tonight, but you're all well represented.
Great. Never a dull moment, huh, Chief?
Yeah, not since January 1st.
Full moon came up last night.
Can't catch a break. Yeah.
How many miles on the roof did he get?
Is there a parade of warranty?
Yeah. And Kevin.
Only report I have is from the latest community listening session. Both myself, Dan Langmuir, and Barry Berman were there in attendance. It was good crowd. I would say probably our largest crowd. Not by much, but it was a pretty good sized crowd. I don't know what the numbers were, but yeah, a lot of new faces. I think Bob had a little bit different spin, basically the same presentation, but a little bit different spin on it. I think that actually led to less questions because we did have a lot of new faces there. I think it was a little, people kind of, their questions were answered before they got into the Q&A portion of the night.
Yep.
Other than the good attendance, good presentation, that's about all I have to report.
Barry.
Likewise.
Okay.
Ditto.
Wow, that was pretty easy, huh?
I
wasn't present, but I saw that, Bob shared the presentation with me. And, I think it's done what it's supposed to. Each time when you have a listening session, and then what happens is you listen, what a concept that is, and then make the adjustments to the things that people seem to be most interested in. So it sounds like we're getting to that place that people are getting we're hearing from them and they're getting the kind of information they need. Any public comment this evening? Yes.
Not entirely familiar with this, not sure.
All you have to do is identify yourself and where you live.
Brian O'Mara, 12 Batchelder Road.
Yep.
And frankly, I'm here to voice my concerns tonight about the cemetery garage project that's being considered by the Permanent Building Committee. Yes, my property abuts Wood End Cemetery, which, as I understand it, is the prime site location for that project. But it's not even my primary concern. My primary concern is, frankly, as a taxpayer, in an environment where we are reducing headcount in the schools, we're reducing town services, but we're still considering a project $1.5 to $3 million in order to house 3 trucks, 5 lawnmowers, and a backhoe. I think even in spite of all the great work Mr. Lasher's done, that Dr. Doherty has done, we haven't passed a level service school budget in 3 years. We can't pass a level service town budget. I think we've all heard, we've been told the grim situation, the financial situation of the town, so I think everybody is expecting an override to be on the ballot in the fall. But in spite of all that, we're still considering potentially a $3 million spend to house a handful of pieces of equipment that frankly are DPW equipment that performs DPW services, and as I see it, frankly, belongs at the DPW. It all has to go there to be fueled and maintained as it is. I also know that, and frankly, I know the current building is beyond its usefulness. I'm not questioning the problem, I'm simply questioning the solution. I know that ultimately there's another larger overall DPW project potentially in the works years down the road, and I know that takes time, but I don't understand why this equipment, this project, would not be part of that overall DPW solution. And again, especially in an environment where we're cutting teachers, we're cutting town services, frankly, I just don't see how this makes sense. I've been to the building committee meetings, I've spoken with several of the cemetery board of trustees. I'm well aware that we're very early in the process. I know that there is not a project per se, but I also know that the bids for project owner have come in, and I know this project is gaining momentum and it's rolling along, and frankly, I didn't want to wait until the fall when there would be public hearings and everybody has an opportunity And again, this is a taxpayer, not just as an abutter.
Sure.
Believe me, all the abutters are very concerned, but I have spoken with taxpayers from precinct 5, precinct 8, precinct 2, that really are beside themselves to hear that this is a project being considered when all these other things are on the table to be cut. So I just don't see how a town of 25,000 residents would require multiple DPW facilities, particularly one in the residential area, right within yards of people's properties. So I know you have a packed agenda tonight. I wanted to be brief. I'll let you get back to your business. But again, I just did not want to go into the fall without voicing my concerns. I would fully expect that you'll probably hear those same concerns from other taxpayers throughout the summer, because you know they're sentiment that belongs. So I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Brian, you're doing pretty good at doing this. That's the first time you did it. I mean, this is exactly the time and place for that. We
yeah.
welcome your comments and others. So thank you very much. Yes.
Larry Gilson, 70 Pearl Street, and you're going to be reviewing the extension of the parking ban on the east side of Longwood, on the east side of Longwood, from 100 feet to 285 feet. And I would like to voice my objection to that. I have an objection to the ban, but I know that's not on the agenda tonight. So what I would like to do is discuss some of the problems that at least I have. Some of the other residents aren't here, but I've discussed with some of the other residents too. I understand this is a difficult problem because you have the narrowing of the street, and I see this every time that LaPierre or Longwood has a function, or if there's games across the street, which I really would like to see the kids continue to have their games across the street. So it's not really the traffic in general that's caused by this, but what happens to the residents is that people do park up on the sidewalk, which I believe is part of the objective to this. And what that does is that totally obscures our ability to back out in what I would consider a safe manner into the street, because we can't see when cars are lined, even if the crest going southbound on the street, we can't see because of the blocks.
Larry, can I just ask you,
yeah.
Public comment is always welcome. That this actually is on our agenda tonight.
Yeah, the 285, but not the parking ban itself. I mean, I would like to go as far as to lift the parking ban and place the cars on the other side of the street. But what on your agenda is the extension from 100 to 285 feet, is that right?
Yeah,
correct.
Right.
Yes,
but
that is correct.
You certainly
so
have that discussion.
I'm kind of using this as a platform to go a little bit farther, but I would like to limit the parking ban to where it is now, because it does impose a burden for the residents. Now, even along that stretch there on the, get my direction stuff here, but on the west side where the residents are, as people park up on the berm, it actually deteriorates the berm. So what we see along most of that area right now is a deterioration where the earth is actually below the road. And so what that causes, it causes puddling, it causes cracking in the road. For us, it's a safety concern to back out. The kids on the other side of the street trying to cross the street, it tends to be a busy area. We have trucks and other cars because it's been a main throughway for a while. I'm voicing my concern and objection to the extension of the ban, making it known that I object to the ban entirely.
Okay. And I would welcome you to stick around for that portion of the discussion.
Yeah.
I think you'd add to that as well. So thank you for your comments, Larry. Yes, sir.
William Dalton, 91 Pearl Street.
Yeah.
Addressing the same.
Okay, so.
Save it for the hearing.
Yeah, we're going to.
Very quickly, this goes back to 1993. I also support the chief and the new parking regulations. I have documentation approved, and I'll present the case.
Good. We're going to be getting to that in the agenda shortly. So welcome your comments. Any other comments from the public on something not otherwise on our agenda here? Okay, Bob.
I feel obliged to answer Brian's points. and to give a little background. I guess the first thing I should say, that the theory is the way we budget into the town, and this is always subject to change, any kind of a debt or capital project, they're really the same, one's just a way to pay for it, is isolated as 5% of the budget. So when you don't do a project such as the Birch Meadow lighting or if the cemetery garage gets canceled, another capital project moves in its place. So under the way we currently do it, you don't save any jobs that way. Now, for the last 2 years, the Finance Committee has relaxed the 5% because of the budget situation to 4.75%. So they could always come up with any new policy they want. So as a practical matter, you know, you could be right that it could save jobs, but I did want to point out that the way we're set up, that just means another capital project would step in. Just to give a real brief history, when this article came up as a petitioned article at town meeting from one of the cemetery trustees, I spoke out very much against it, and I objected to it because I didn't believe adequate study had been done, and I discussed the desire to have a single DPW garage in the future to accommodate this. The reason, however, that it is now a project in front of the Permanent Building Committee is it was an instructional meeting passed by town, or motion passed by town meeting. So they asked us to do that.
Right.
The Permanent Building Committee is newly formed in the fall. This is their first project. I guarantee you they have a lot of opinions on their process, and I'll tell you, one of them is they think it's inappropriate for cemetery trustees, as an example, to be part of their committee until there is a project. So that's one of the complaints I've got that you'll see as a potential change to a bylaw next November. So they also feel like they needed to be more independent, but I explained to them, okay, that's fine for the future, but again, an instructional motion put these people in front of you.
Yep.
Just to explain what we're doing, town meeting appropriated $200,000 in the current year for the process. Because of interesting mass procurement laws, we had to secure an owner's project manager for a very small project. And that's the RFP that is being evaluated right now by the committee. I don't know, since no bids were put in, we'll have to negotiate a fee, but our full expectation is $50,000 or less will cover that cost. When I stood in front of town meeting in April and I explained that, I asked for 150 of the 200 to be moved into the next year to hire an architect to design it. So you have a project manager, then you'll have an architect that'll look at the two cemeteries that have been selected, look at probably more than one site in each cemetery, and have some back and forth with the committee and the abutters, I know they've been in a couple times, and come up with some final suggestions. And that is expected to cost up to $150,000. So it certainly is debatable as to whether that should go forward, but that's town meeting's will. But under no circumstances would I recommend anything further go on after that work stops.
Yeah.
And I don't think you're going to see the architect nearly ready for November town meeting or even April. He's got 6 months work to do probably. But if the architect were ready for, let's say, annual town meeting, I would stand up and say I do not recommend any building project until we sort out the long-term situation of the DPW garage. So I'm sympathetic to your point, but I'm just not sure if we shouldn't spend any money to develop a real good cost estimate and an alternative that we may need down the road. One of the criticisms of projects, you know, that Barry certainly brought up on FinCom is the lack of good work up front and alternatives being presented to the community. So, you know, there's one library, it was only one location and it had one design. So if this does go forward and upwards of $200,000 is spent, at least you'll have, if not plan A, plan B for a cemetery garage in a cemetery.
Yep.
So I don't philosophically object to that, and I just wanted to sort of give you that as background. But I certainly take your point.
Yep. And I would say that not a dissimilar situation recently occurred that you might have read in the paper or heard about, and that is that there was a capital project, and I think it's important. Bob points out there are capital projects and there's the operating budget, and they really don't collide necessarily. However, your point is certainly well taken when there's such dramatic concerns about our operating budget and the ability to be able to fund it. The idea that we'd be spending a large amount of money on almost anything until it's vetted as to exactly how our budget is going to be corrected is a point well taken. And to that point, there was a capital project that was designed around the expansion of recreational opportunities over at Birch Meadow. Now, that came in at a 40% increase over, you know, what the expectation was. And after a disappointing due process, we had to say that town meeting had said to us, light five fields, so in order to do that would cause a 40% increase in cost or a reduction of two fields, and that wasn't the right thing to do for all, I think really, Brian, for all the reasons that you're bringing up. So I know that those of us on the Board of Selectmen are looking very hard at all of these things, and you know, your point is certainly well taken. To Bob's point, you know, one of the things that happened in that lighting project, for example, was that $100,000 was spent. Now, that $100,000 was spent in order to understand the geology of, at some point in the future, you know, the hope would be that that expanded lighting would go on, you know, when times are better, the bidding process works itself out the way that we need it to. And occasionally, whether it's examining alternatives around the cemetery building and spending some money, not the big money necessarily, or you know, in the case of the Birch Meadow project, $100,000 was spent, but the money is not lost. The work is done. The geology is not going to change, you know. So these are things that and I'm guessing, Brian, you might have been at one of the listening sessions. These are things that we're trying to clarify so that people do understand about capital projects versus operating budget, and money spent, that helps you better understand whether to go forward and how to go forward if you do. So these public comments are very valuable and timely and thoughtful. So I would thank you for that. Bob, was there something else?
Yeah, if you don't mind. On Sunday, I thanked the police chief and the superintendent and myself. We all decided it was a good choice to give up some Father's Day time and go to the Congregational Church for a community meeting. And
yes.
It was really interesting. It wasn't a high turnout, as you'd expect, really, on that day. It was a very diverse turnout. There's a lot of different opinions in the room. There was 40 or 50 people there. Just discussing what had happened in Orlando and, you know, some of the implications. And, you know, I was in a really interesting working group that included ministers and a couple of other people, and it was kind of the management level discussion of religion. I found that pretty interesting because they're running organizations and, you know, we're running organizations. We had a lot in common, as it turned out. They're having a lot of the same issues we are with, you know, Gen X, as it were, getting their attention and keeping their attention. So it was pretty interesting, and I just mostly wanted to thank the chief and the superintendent, you know, for taking time out that day. It was really appreciated. And lastly, just at the end of today, we did get in a new proposal for the train depot 40B. It is much improved. It'll need to be certainly vetted by staff, but they have cut one floor off the top down to four. They have pulled back all the setbacks.
Excellent.
Mostly the three biggest pullbacks are from the front and the sides, not the rear, but there is a pullback from the rear. Mm-hmm. And they've reduced the unit count. I don't think they mentioned parking. Did you see anything on parking?
I didn't.
Okay. So I just wanted to let you know that some progress is being made. And is the next meeting this Thursday?
I think so.
Yeah,
okay.
Thursday at 7
so
at the Pleasant Street Center, right?
Okay. So I just wanted to let the board know that.
I do think it's, first of all, it was exciting to see those changes that came in hot off the presses this afternoon. And I do think it's important for people to realize that, you know, all the people, all the people to my left and my right have worked hard on a lot of different projects. One of them is this one. I know Kevin Sexton has put an enormous amount of time into connecting parties so that things could maybe progress in a little different way and truly create something that, instead of, you know, the entire town being at odds, now suddenly there's a more workable project. I want to thank you, Kevin, for your hard work in that regard and mm-hmm. the urgings of your friends to your left and your right, you know, in that regard.
Thank you very much.
Yep. Okay. Yes, I don't think we have any proclamations, do we?
No.
Good. Okay, so.
I hope not.
Report of the VASC, Dan.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the volunteer appointment subcommittee met again this evening. We had two principal items of discussion. One, the need to revote the terms on all the associate members. Upon a closer reading of the bylaw, those terms needed to be 2 years, not one. Yeah. Some were previously recommended to you and then voted by you as 1 year.
Yeah.
The you're all supposed to arrange it so an equal number expire each year, so we are recommending a mix of one and two for some boards and two for others. So I'll be proposing motions for reconsidering our previous vote on that and then the new terms. We also had, did you have a question?
No.
Okay. We have three offices which were not voted on because people did not show up. We still have not seen either candidate for constable, so we're not putting either candidate's name in nomination this evening.
Okay.
And the CPDC associate was unable to make it, so we'll vote that at a certain point. Neither, I believe, are critical.
So we're going to pass on both of
those?
We'll
pass on those. We did interview both incumbents on the CONSCOM. Both came in this evening, Jamie Malm and Anika Scanlon. We thank them for doing that. Previously, on the 7th, we interviewed Dave Panette. So we have three candidates going for two spots. Mr. Malm volunteered to step back and become an associate member in view of the new applicant, which I thought was a generous offer on his part. So that'll be for your consideration this evening. We'll put motions up for that. So shall I begin, or are there any questions?
No.
Okay.
Any questions from?
Why don't we do the? Let's do the associates first. That's partway down the page here. Move that the Board of Selectmen reconsider the previous associate member votes. That should cover it, right?
Yeah.
Second. Any discussion?
You don't have to read them, do you?
No.
Got to vote on this first.
All those in favor?
I'll read. Okay, so that vacates our previous nomination.
Does it vacate, or does it simply
no, it
open
vacates.
The question?
It's like we never passed anything. It
right.
just takes the motion
takes them away.
RCTV is deleting it right now.
Yeah.
All right, so to put them back, move that the Board of Selectmen accept the recommendations of the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee, for the associate members as follows. Animal Control, Joyce Gould, and these are all, unless I mention it, their terms ending 6/30/18, so I won't read all the ones that are 6/30/18. Animal Control, Joyce Gould, Board of Health, Nancy Doctor, Climate Advisory Committee, Jeffrey Everson, for a term ending 6/30/17, Gina Snyder, term ending 6/30/18, Commissioner of Trust Funds, Richard Holmes, Council on Aging, Pooja Parsons, Fall Street Fair Committee, Allison Ullman, Historic District, Jack Williams, Historical Commission, Virginia Adams. And for Recreation Committee, we can have three associates here. We vacated the previous vote. We're recommending Mary Ellen Stalecki for an associate term ending 6/30/18, and Catherine Kaminer for a term ending 6/30/18, and Gil Congdon for a term ending 6/30/17. On the Town Forest Committee, we can have three, as it turned out. So I will put all three back into nomination. Michael Bork, term ending 6/30/18. Daniel Ford, term ending 6/30/18. Nancy Doctor, term ending 6/30/17. And finally, for Trails Committee, Associate John Parsons, for term ending 6/30/18.
Second.
Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Thank you. All right, let's do, we're going to skip Constable and CPDC Associate. I'm going to place the following, let me give you a report of the vote of the VASC. We put all three names into nomination for the full membership. Jamie Malm received one vote. David Panette received one vote. Anika Scanlon received two votes. So it will be up to the board to decide which of those two.
And are these for the two?
Well, we'll do the full membership first, and then we will vote, put into nomination anyone who did not succeed by vote of the board for associate, and then the board can act as it sees fit. So
okay.
Make sense?
Got it.
So I'm going to put into nomination for full membership on the Conservation Commission for terms ending 6/30/19. These are full three-year terms. Jamie Malm, David Panette, and Anika Scanlon, and everybody will get two votes here. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Jamie Malm. David Panette. Anika Scanlon. Okay. Did you call the vote? What was the vote on Panette? Four?
Four.
Four.
Okay.
Anika.
Okay. Five. So David and Anika are elected. I'll put the name of Jamie Mom into nomination for an associate membership on the Conservation Commission for a term ending 6/30/18. Is there a second?
Did the VASC take a position on that?
We did not take a conclusive position. I'm just putting it out there for the board to vote if it so chooses.
How many associate memberships are open?
They can have up to four because they're a committee of seven.
Yeah, and actually that was one of the discussions that we had in terms of kind of, you know, what's your needs list going forward. They struggled with quorum. It's a pretty time-intensive committee, as we all know. It'd be people who are doing it for a long time. There's a sense of burnout. So there was a general consensus that developing a deep bench is something that should be a priority both of the committee and of the Board of Selectmen going forward, to sort of start thinking about recruiting people to replace those who've been doing it for a while and who at some point maybe want to step down. So we also discussed sort of skill sets, you know, what, you know, kind of, if you had to build the committee from scratch, what are you missing? So we had discussion on that. So it was a pretty good.
Yeah, two incumbents contributed materially to that, I thought.
How many associates are there present?
Zero.
None.
Zero.
None. Jamie is the senior fellow there. He's been on and off of that, I think, but his last term began in 2010, I think. So he's been there. This will be his sixth year.
Yeah, and he specifically stated he wanted to actually stay involved, but as an associate.
Yeah.
Wanted
so that,
to get new
that's
people
the pleasure
in, so.
Of the board of style. They, instance, we were inconclusive as to who we recommended.
So I guess I'm confused. If that's the position he asked for, I wondered why his name was put in as a full
because
member.
We didn't know that until he showed up.
Oh. So that happened after the interviews?
Well, I mean, in fairness to all, I thought I'd put all the names in.
Okay.
The board might have a different view.
How many members that that make
seven?
Seven
full,
and
they may have up to four associates under the bylaw.
Four associates.
Right.
Okay.
So, do you want me to remake that motion, Mr. Chairman? Or?
Well, I think you've made the motion I think you've nominated
Jamie Mon.
Jamie Mon.
Right now, he's the only candidate for associate
as an associate member
for a two-year term. I don't know if you got a second on that or not.
I do not have a second.
All right.
Second.
A second. Discussion. Okay, hearing no discussion, all those in favor?
Two votes.
All
motion.
Those opposed?
Motion does not carry.
Okay.
That concludes the business under our appointments. A couple of hearings.
Okay, so I believe it's hearing time. Is that right, Bob?
Yep.
Yep. This is the for the approval of the FY17 non-union classification and compensation plans.
Please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading will hold a public hearing on June 21st, 2016 in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass, to approve on the following: approve FY17 non-union classification compensation plan 7-20, increase the
No, not yet. For that
one. That's it.
Well, you can read.
We gotta let Judy tell us about it first.
There really aren't very many changes this year. It's just a couple of items that I think are still vacant.
Point of order, the secretary did not read the full notice, just so we don't get in any trouble here.
Oh.
Pick it up at a copy of.
Oh, a copy of the proposed document regarding this topic
sorry,
is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass, Thursday, 7:30 to 5:30 p.m., Tuesday, 7:30 to 7 p.m., and attached to the hearing notice on the website, www.readingmass.gov. You know the rest.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
Okay, I think we're rolling now.
Yes.
Are you issuing special glasses to read that? Because my old eyes can't even, I have no idea. I know there's something lit up there, but that's about it.
Well, there's really no changes to this particular schedule. It's the same that you voted on in the spring. There you go.
Oh.
There are some positions here that are currently vacant, but there's really no changes to this particular schedule.
Okay.
The next schedule, which is the pay in class or the classification for the compensation, that is inclusive of a 2% COLA that was voted on by town meeting, and the graphs are as such.
Okay.
I'd be more than happy to answer any questions.
Pretty straightforward there.
Self-explanatory.
So what's on anybody's mind? We've got Judy in the hot seat.
Yeah, exactly.
Been there before.
Yeah. This seems like it's just a very straightforward, you know, move year over year.
Yeah, former Lawrence City Councilor, so.
Lawrence City Councilor, so.
What's that? Oh, yeah, that's right. She's a Lawrence City Councilor in her other life.
My other life, yes. Long ago.
Yeah, well, we're very calm compared to those guys, I'll tell you that.
Oh, yeah.
I think so. So, any other thoughts or questions? Bob, any comments from you? We good? Any public comment?
One quick question.
Yes, John.
Bob, is there any of this increase due to the step up to full-time? There were a couple of positions that were going to 37.5.
That wouldn't reflect a change in either of your classifications. It might require more money in a budget, but it's the same basic outline. If you look at this second picture here, what you actually approve is an hourly wage. And then for the convenience of payroll, we provide a 37.5 and a 40-hour week.
It's just a wage.
Yeah.
So it's all right.
Yeah.
Public comment?
Any public comment? I think our next move is to close the hearing.
Move the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on the approval of the FY17 non-union classification and compensation plan.
Second.
Any discussion? Those in favor?
5-0.
5-0.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the FY17 non-union classification and compensation plan as presented.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? 5-0.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Judy.
Thank you.
She said that was an hour shorter than Lawrence would have been.
We'll try to do better next time.
No, you don't have any of this. You can do whatever you want.
Okay, Sharon, you're on.
I just wanted to start by thanking all of you for the beautiful flowers you sent to my brother's service. It was very appreciated by me and my family, so I just figured I would mention that because it's the first time I've seen all of you together. I've seen each one of you at the different listening sessions that we went to, so I just wanted to tell you how much we appreciate it, and they were beautiful. And I wanted to start by talking about the position over at the school department that is going to be vacating, which is the finance director. Martha has given her notice, and she'll be leaving, I think, first week in August. And I just want to let you know that, you know, I plan to do everything I can to help the school while they look for a competent replacement. I don't want them to rush to pick anybody just to have somebody. I certainly will do whatever I can to help. And I just wanted to let you guys know that. I don't know if it brings you any comfort. I think they're probably more nervous about it than you guys
it
are,
does.
But I figured I would mention,
it does.
You know,
yeah.
Whatever
it brings
I can
yeah, it brings
do.
Us a lot of comfort.
A lot of comfort.
We had a big to-do list working together going forward, so just wanted that to kind of hopefully, obviously they need to find the person and bring them up to speed.
Yeah, and I am on the search committee as
great.
Well, so
that's
that
helpful.
Can help
great.
Input
excellent.
Of, you know, who they're picking and whatnot. So I just figured I would just leave with that just because it's kind of a big issue.
Yeah, certainly.
Yes, Bob.
If you don't mind, I may as well add, since Judy's still sitting here and hasn't thought to escape, the school's HR director has resigned, effective in a couple weeks, so that vacancy will be short-term. And Judy has made the same offer to the school department that, you know, we have the shared position, plus we have Judy, and we'll pitch in any way we can to help the schools as they go through whatever process they need to fill the job, again, with a good person long-term. So,
okay.
Go ahead. Sorry.
Okay.
And I know, Sharon, you have been working closely with Martha on a lot of different issues, I think, over the last year that I can
recall.
Yeah,
we've worked pretty well together.
Yeah.
I mean, and I hope that the replacement will be somebody that will work with me and, you know, that
absolutely.
We get along well like we have. You know, I've worked well with Mary and Martha, so there hasn't been any issues between the town and the school and working together on things. So
that's great.
Hoping
good.
For more of that going forward. But, you know, it's nice to be on the search committee to be able to have input into
yep.
who that decision
is. I'm sure the school committee feels good about that, too, because, you know, it's a
and
I think that is a higher, a school committee hire, isn't
it's
it?
It's a school
yeah.
committee
yeah.
hire.
That's what I thought.
But they take, I think the search committee presents however many candidates they
sure.
think are viable candidates, and then the school committee selects or says no, go back and, you know.
So where are they in that process?
I think they just have
collected?
I think
yeah.
A description is out there. I think that I spoke to Martha today, and they had some applicants already,
okay.
although a small number. So we'll see what happens. I think she was told that they were looking to do something to start interviewing sometime mid-July, but I don't know. I guess it just depends on the volume of what they're getting and if they have anything in that mix that looks like a good fit. So we'll see. I think John said he would let me know when they were going to get started and all that, and make sure that I didn't have vacation plan time, which I do not. I just came back from vacation, so it should be fine. So hopefully that brings you guys comfort. I'm hoping it brings the school committee some comfort, mm-hmm. because I certainly will be willing to do anything to help them.
Well,
so.
It's good that they don't have to rush, because, you know, first of all, the middle of the dead of summer is a very challenging time to hire in any business.
And it's not
any,
a typical time
business,
that
you know.
Somebody like that would be looking, because it's really a bad time to vacate your position.
Yeah.
Most
right.
people don't want to leave at that time. It's a very, very busy time of year for both the school and the town side. We're closing
yeah.
up the year. There's a lot of reporting that gets done. It's really not an ideal time to need that position replaced. And then there's also some options of maybe some people that we can bring in to help, you know, because I'm only one person, you know, their needs are great. So, you know, there's some options out there. So I'm sure we'll entertain all of them, but I certainly am willing to do whatever needs to be done to move things forward, and I thought I'd mention that. So the other thing I wanted to tell you is for fiscal 16, we're in good shape. We're about $17,000 shy of 100% of revenues collected, and that's with $1.2 million still coming in from the state next week. So
well.
We're probably going to have in excess of budget at least $1 million, like most years, for revenues.
Is that local aid, tax revenues? $16,000 short of 100%?
Well, yeah, but we still have 9 days and we collect a lot every day.
No, but I'm saying that's,
yeah.
that's a small, I mean.
That's a small.
It's a tiny amount.
So
we're
like,
almost at, I mean, basically it's 99.9%.
So that's assuming that everybody's, like, there's nobody delinquent on their property
well,
taxes.
Well, we make assumptions when we put our budget in of, like, a certain amount of abatements, like $650,000.
Right.
So that means the abatements are less than what we, you know,
oh,
what
God.
We put in that pool. So we got 100%, and we tend to be over 100% on revenues, projected revenues. And then there are things that we get in revenues that we don't project for
can't
because
predict.
We don't know they're coming. Sometimes that's FEMA money because it might be a storm that maybe we get approved for later. We don't
mm-hmm.
know it's coming,
right.
so it won't be budgeted. I know Maya dividends, those are things that we seem to be getting every year, but you can never count on it. It's their discretion whether they give it or not, but that tends to help the pool. So there's things like that that are kind of built-ins that actually help us in that regard. But
well, I would say that's in my mind, that's a real tribute to the way that you budget. I think that kind of conservative approach to not be overly aggressive in expectation
yeah.
pays dividend later. And, you know,
yeah,
as Barry points out, the idea
hold.
Of coming in that close.
I mean, if every business had an A&R that was at 99.9%, I think we'd be.
Yeah.
Yeah, the money we hold for capital projects, even though we know it might be earning interest, we don't project, you know,
right.
for that because it would be all over the place. We want it to be more like what we would really earn without
yep.
that money. So things like that are kind of built in. So I'm expecting at least $1 million over projection for fiscal 16. Expenses were at like 92%, but it's kind of hard to call what that's going to do because at that last week, people are, you know, finalizing all their stuff, and then also all the payroll that goes on for those last 2 weeks of June are going to be processed. So it's kind of hard to say.
It seems inevitable every year we have
some extra yeah.
bills that we've got to get special dispensation to pay because they run in, you know, at the end too.
Salaries tend to be like for fire, like overtime. Sometimes things just run over, and
yep.
we go to FinCom for that or whatnot. So we are in good shape. I'm not overly concerned about anything in that regard. We recently had a ratings call because we did issue bonds today,
mm-hmm.
and we do still maintain our AAA bond rating, and we issued bonds at 1.26% today for the library project,
perfect.
The retaining
yeah.
wall, the
yeah.
modulars.
Bob sent us that good news today. I think just, you know, stop and say that again.
yeah.
yeah.
We issued
seriously.
Debt at 1.26%. Percent.
Insane.
That is not a reflection of just that money is cheap. It's a reflection of the credit rating that the town has,
yep.
mm-hmm.
of which that we have gotten because of the fiscal prudent financial planning and management and the hard decisions that we've made over the years and will continue to make.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't by accident. So I need to state that and be crystal clear.
And that is with the uncertainty of that TLT litigation that's going on. Even knowing that we have that out there and not knowing a number, they still felt comfortable leaving that AAA bond rating on us because we are so strong.
And we borrowed again, what was the number? 1.26%.
1.26%.
I'm writing that down.
And we were excited about the 1.49% of the last issuance, and we even went lower than that.
Yeah, so everybody understands what that is. We actually sell bonds, and, you know, there's a rating at what those cost, based on its rating, they cost a certain amount.
Mm-hmm.
And I think people queue right up to buy a AAA bond, and
mm-hmm.
so our debt is viable.
Right.
I would echo what Barry's saying. It's a tribute to the way that things have been done, despite the fact that, we all know that we're facing certain financial challenges. Accounting for our money and keeping track and being fiscally prudent is not what our problem is.
Mm-hmm.
And that's now been fortified by a national rating agency.
Yeah.
So
back to back, the last rating was the AAA. And so very, very good, and says a lot about how strong we are financially. So
And the different, the rate that we would have gotten if we maybe were in AAA, how many, hundreds of thousands?
They don't ever quote you that.
But is it safe to say it's...
Mm, it's really hard. It's hard to know.
It's hard to know.
It wouldn't be hundreds of thousands.
It would be tens of thousands?
Probably.
Oh.
But we have a better rating than the U.S. government, so that's...
That's not hard to say.
We work hard.
We pay our bills.
Last I checked, there was no printing press in the basement.
Yeah.
No.
And just one other thing on that. We refinanced some old water debt, the MWRA buy-in, actually.
Yep,
it saved $500,000 for our water ratepayers over
yep.
the next few years.
That's
great.
Thinking,
yeah.
And, it didn't receive a lot of attention at the time, but a few years back, we saved $3.5 million for the taxpayers by refinancing the high school debt. And that wasn't the case where $3.5 million is freed up to spend on something else. It was $3.5 million the taxpayers did not have to pay the town as part of that exclusion.
Right.
So that's a pretty big number. But if you divide it by the number of years and the number of households, suddenly it only became a couple $100 a household. But still, $3.5 million is $3.5 million.
And I think, Bob, one of the things that, look, the average person gets their tax bill and they don't look at how much they saved. They look at how much it is.
Mm-hmm.
And it's generally more than it was the year before. So I think it is important to pause and talk about the fact that those kinds of steps, I mean, the step with the school was... that is material. $3.5 million worth of...
The way I explained it to FinCom at the time, knowing it wasn't really apples and apples, is, the library took two votes, $10 million and $3.5 million. The second one was really free. Not really, but we saved that much by refinancing the high school. So it didn't cost taxpayers any more than we had just done nothing.
Hmm.
I think it is important for the public to be aware of that, and I think it's worth the pause. I'm glad Barry slowed us down here for a second to
mm-hmm.
talk about this. For people to realize that there is somebody at the switch, paying attention.
We're constantly looking for the opportunity to refund this debt at lower rates,
mm-hmm.
especially with the AAA bond rate.
It worked hard to get it. So.
Yes, exactly. The other issue I had to discuss was the audit committee met on May 5th to talk about the results of the fiscal 15 audit, which went very well. We didn't have any findings of any kind to really discuss. They, some heads up about some changes that are coming forward, but that, nothing that was cause for concern like we had with the revolving funds last year.
Mm-hmm.
So, and they had come out the following week to do preliminary audit work. I was not here because of my brother, but. That went well, and they will be back in September to do their final audit work. They always come up pretty early, but for whatever reason, we always end up having that meeting later. I don't know. it takes a long time to wrap it up, or maybe they get going on other projects, but they usually do most of their field work with us in September, and maybe they come back and do a couple things, a couple months later, but for some reason, we can't seem to get the audit committee together before, like, May or June. I'm not sure why.
Yeah.
Did you have a question?
Yeah, Sharon. So last year when we met, the revolving funds were the topic of the opinion letter. Do you have a view as to where they sit today now as we bring this year to a close?
I feel like they're doing much, much better because we had some plans of what to do to try and correct the situation. There was no immediate solution that was going to correct it, completely right it, because you can't take anything out of the revolving fund that's not related to
correct.
Its intent. So if it's pre-K, it's got to be for pre-K. If it's extended, so you can't really charge the fund for more than what it costs to run the program. But we did have, for the special ed program, There was one year that they didn't take the offset at all, I think it was fiscal 13. So we made the decision to charge more in the current year as a correction, and DOR seemed to agree that that would be our right. You know, so we did some things of that nature, and there were certain enrichments that were done to programs like capital items that are one-time things for those programs to start to bring those balances down. So, and Martha had agreed, and hopefully the new person who replaces her will agree, that we will take the support that is budgeted, that is the cost of the program,
right,
you know, unless there's some extenuating circumstances why. And the only circumstance I could see is that there isn't the money there because maybe the numbers didn't come in as what we thought. Otherwise, I expect that support to be exactly what they budgeted, and I won't book the entry for them unless they make that case to me, because now that DOR has supported that that's the way it's supposed to be, and our auditors are supporting that, because it's a very gray area, and you get a lot of pushback when you say, well, I don't agree. It's their budget. And now that we've gotten a management letter comment that points to this is the way it has to be, and it's still a little bit gray, so, well, how much money can be in there? Well, not 2 years worth.
Right.
You know, so we just need to get down to 6 months, maybe, I would feel comfortable with. But
could you,
anything.
Could you, not tonight, because you don't have the numbers in front of you, but could you just generate a quick memo to summarize where we started last year, this time, where
and
we
where
are
we are currently? I certainly can.
Yeah, when you
and
get a
send
chance.
That out. Yeah.
That'd be great. Thank you.
Yeah. It's still a continued item.
Mm-hmm. It's something that's, you know, anytime something goes wrong, it becomes an area that's on my radar, you know, to be looked at more frequently than it would have been prior. So, you know, something like a management letter comment on something, it doesn't fall on deaf ears here. We definitely want to correct it and keep it corrected, not let it come up again. So.
As I recall from serving on the audit committee at one point, isn't every year, doesn't some area come up for special consideration?
Yes, they test on a kind of, you know, kind of a cycle, all the different areas where cash is collected or where there's an increased risk. And so we can highlight certain things and say, hey, you know, this is an area where, you know, the audit committee can say that we think you really should do your testing this year. And I think that in fiscal 16, revolving funds are going to be reviewed because it's given us that 1 year of a correction to see what kind of progress are we making. So the auditors are going to do it as part of the internal control testing.
Good.
Take a look and see what kind of progress we made and if they're satisfied with it. And they will comment on it, so because it's being revisited and it was a prior management letter comment. And they did say that they felt that our corrections were going in the right direction. So we'll see if they feel that way when they're looking, you know, more detailed. Because we did spend a lot of time determining what the program's cost, what the projected revenues are, and are those closely aligned. And in most cases, yes, they were. It was just that one thing that they were doing differently. It's just I felt like it was just a difference of opinion on how it gets done. You know, I think that there was a certain amount of budget certainty that they wanted. They wanted to say, well, if I'm going to budget support, I want the money to be already there. I get that, but that's not the intent of the fund. So now that we have that clarification, I think going forward, we're going to all be on the same page about how to manage those funds. So I don't envision that we'll have another problem with them, but we shall see. It depends, I guess, on, you know, who comes in and how hard
they
push
that
back.
Certainly can become part of the interview process.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely. Well, I mean, I remember Martha had mentioned when she had come on, because she hadn't been a school business manager or finance director for a school before, she had a mentor. And when that whole thing came up regarding the management letter, she had mentioned it to her mentor. How would you have dealt with this? And she said those funds should have closed to free cash. You should have taken the full amount of support. So it was nice to hear that, you know, an experienced school business manager who works in the field, who's retired from the field, felt the same way. So that kind of reiterated to her that yes, this isn't just a difference opinion on our auditors and me, but that others in the field see it that way too.
Along with the update on those accounts, you know, a management letter is kind of the last thing you want to see. It's the last safeguard that tells you something's wrong. If you ever have any view or an opinion as to something that's trending in a direction, long before an opinion letter would be needed, please don't hesitate to bring it up. Even if it's just conversational or awareness or did you know, that's fine.
Exactly. I will.
Yes, Bob.
Just to make it clear, Sharon's predecessor had this discussion with Martha's predecessor many times, and they just disagreed. So,
yeah,
they had the same opinion as that retired school business person, and just didn't have a mechanism to enforce it on the schools.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't so black and white where you could point to the law and says, it says you can only have X amount of dollars, or it, you know what I mean? It was so gray that you couldn't win the argument, so you just...
Well, it sounds like...
Heading in the right direction.
Yeah, it sounds like progress has been made, and, you know, everything's moving along, and that's really what, the end of the day, that's what's most important.
The school and the town are on the same page now, which is good, so. Other than that, I just want to kind of let you know what I will be doing. June through November is my busiest time of year, so I will be straight out, closing the year, getting free cash certified, doing the tax rate setting. End of year report, I've always done a portion of it. I don't know if I'll be doing all of it this year, who knows? But end of year is actually the school report that goes to DESE. Martha had been doing it. I'm familiar with it. I've never done it myself in its entirety, but I never did a Schedule A before I came here, so I'm quite sure I could follow along. So yeah, I'll be doing a lot of reporting and then planning for the audit, and then any budget work that happens in October. So that June through November, I'm completely straight out.
And
so.
Certification of free cash probably happens in the early fall. Do I remember that right?
Yeah, normally I close the books late August, early September, and then I can calculate free cash. I usually do it sometime mid-September, I'd say, mid to late September.
So will we know that? I guess the reason I'm asking that question, I anticipate as we have visits with citizens and town meeting.
We might know it, yeah.
It would be probably a good thing. I mean, I know it's out of your control. You
the
can only take it so far.
The only thing that's out of
so
my control is how quickly DOR
yeah,
can
DOR
come to
one.
Us. Because if, yeah,
yeah
because
DOR
they,
is very unlikely to certify it by our, for instance, if you have a September special town meeting. I don't
probably
think
won't
gonna,
be ready.
No.
It was just a curiosity of
but
mine.
We do tend to get it fairly early compared to some of our peer communities. But where we,
yeah.
our DOR rep did retire, we do have
right.
a replacement. I think that they have less staff than they had prior, so I would expect some delays in getting that kind of thing done, the free cash certification and the tax rate
yeah.
setting. All of, I think the tax rate setting, I think they work hard to try and move those along because they know people can't send those tax bills without that setting.
Right.
So it is going to be a particularly busy time of year for me, but if there's anything that I can do for you guys, additional research or anything of that nature, just let me know.
Okay.
Do you have any questions for me?
Thank you.
Any questions for Sharon that we haven't already raised?
No.
Thank you very much.
Great.
Thank you, Sharon. As always, thorough and timely. Thank you very much. I think we've got another hearing to get open here.
Please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading will hold a public hearing on June 21st, 2016 in the Selectmen's Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. To increase the number of... increase the no parking on the easterly side in front of 75 Pearl Street from 100 feet to 285 feet.
Sure.
Copy of the proposed document regarding the topic is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, et cetera, et cetera.
Welcome, Chief.
Good evening. What brings me here tonight, one of three, is we've had several complaints of parking on both sides of Pearl Street in the last few months since I've taken over. Yeah, it's due to the fact of sporting events going on at the Pearl Street School, or the old Pearl Street School.
Sure. I'm not like Peter, I don't know every street in
town. So, right here, cars are parked on both sides of the road. It narrows it down, very restrictive for to get emergency vehicles down the road. Cars are parked on both sides. So right now, currently, it allows for 100 feet, which is from the entrance of Longwood, about 100 feet apart from the here, of no parking. And also from
it's much more fun to walk.
From a fire emergency entranceway right here to Belmont for no parking. So what? So if I get through. So
let me kill some lights.
Turn the lights down a little bit, and we'll have it. Oh yeah. Popcorn.
So after meeting with the parking traffic transportation task force, we've come up. We improved through the task force to come in front of you to restrict parking from the 100-foot spot all the way to the fire department access road, which is right here, which is an additional 185 feet to allow parking only on one side, basically in front of the whole 75 Pearl Street. That's our proposal so far.
Questions?
Yeah.
Yes.
One of the things you're always worrying about this is unintended consequences. You've got a fixed number of cars that can't go there. Any thought about where we redirect that excess traffic so that we don't have so some of the issues we heard tonight.
Right, so we would consider all of, and I know it's a little bit of a walk, but anywhere on Belmont Street, it is very, Belmont Street's a very wide road, so anywhere on Belmont Street, they could park in all that area.
Would we put, is the thought that we'd put informational signage or a, you know, park here arrow or words to that?
Absolutely, we'd gladly, I'll speak with recreation, we could gladly come up with something like that as well. The problem is, I think, is that it's just been really busy in the park, so I drove down there myself personally when there was events going on, and it really is difficult in that area to have cars parked on both sides of the road.
I live at that little house on the edge of the map, and you cannot get on Pearl Street. I mean, and you worry about kids jumping out between the cars, so.
And I guess our thought process was where there is an actual granite sidewalk on this side, was to limit it where people could park a little bit more on the shoulder on the westerly side to allow for that, because
right.
There is no restrictions right now on the westerly side at all. It's only on the easterly side of Pearl Street currently.
What's the width of that street? If folks parked on the street entirely, what would be the remaining width of the street, do you think? It's obviously single lane, but.
Yeah, I don't have the numbers, to be honest with you. I'd have to talk to the engineer or go out and measure, but it is
it's
narrow.
Tight.
You know, mm-hmm. It is tight, yeah. Yes,
sir. Chief, what was the thought? How come it never was extended that full length? What was the thought process that stopped it?
That's when we actually went back. I had Officer Savio, the safety officer, to go back and look. We couldn't find the history on why it only went 100 feet.
Hmm.
But we actually researched a little bit going back, and there was nothing we could find why it only went 100, because we thought, we thought it would be the whole thing. When I had him go look, he said, Officer, we need to extend it the whole way, which is another 185 pass where it is currently.
Is there the capacity on that street to do cut-ins by maybe on a future project?
Angled parking.
Not so much angle, but even just, you know, parallel parking, but not obviously where it is now. You'd have to cut into where the sidewalk area is.
Take more of the tree lawn, in other words.
Yeah, and then you know, that would obviously have to extend the sidewalk as well, too. Is there enough area over there for
right
that?
Yet. So there's a fence back abutting the sidewalk, so you'd really, that would be an issue, I think, at that point, unless we came into that hole. We have to move the fence and everything at that point.
And this, yeah, so that's right next to the athletic field is what we're talking about. Is that right?
Right.
Although it does have a fair amount of clearance on the field. I don't know exactly, but I bet you could easily get 5 feet if you chose to, an additional 5 or 7 feet if you wanted to move that fence.
I do think that's private property, though, right?
Well, however far the town's rights go.
Except for the people who get out there with swords on Sunday mornings. Mm. They're right on the edge.
Yes, sir. So I'm going to need to ask you to identify yourself just for the record. Thanks. Thank you, William.
Okay.
And Chief and I have gone over this, I've actually gone back to Chief Silva. That little bit of a bend in the road right in the middle makes it that the cars going northbound right there cannot see anything coming southbound. When the cars are parked on the school side of the road, forcing everybody going north into the southbound lane.
Yep.
Southbound can't see northbound coming until it's too late. I've actually seen the ambulance on its way to the assisted living facility come down Charles Street, around the corner in front of my house, go maybe 30 feet, have to stop because this car's coming northbound in the southbound lane, back up, go back up Charles Street, down Harrison, up Orange, and back down Pearl Street to get to the assisted living facility. Now you're saying cut into the sidewalk. Pearl Street has just put a new circular driveway in front of the, what used to be the front door to the school.
Right.
It's now the front door to the facility. They have moved the soccer field out to the street.
Right.
You're saying it's less than 5 feet between the fence and the new field.
I am very familiar with what you're talking about.
On the right-hand side of that one,
you're right.
The school street, or the school side of the street, your question was how much room is left in the southbound lane.
I forgot about the new construction.
Less than 10 feet.
You're right.
Okay.
I have measured the street. I'm a former police officer, and I did traffic studies. I've measured all that out. I have the photographs. This problem goes back to 1993. It's been worked on, it's been researched, all the way back to Chief Silva, his staff, Chief Cormier's staff, Chief Sagala's staff. We finally get the cars off that side of the street, so at least when people coming north or south, you can see across that bend as to what's coming before it's too late.
And so it's your, I interpret what you're saying as an endorsement of the chief's recommendation.
That's correct.
Maybe that's where that 100-foot stopped originally, was just so people could see around that bend.
And I have with me photographs of that area with cars jammed up on both sides, an oil truck stuck in the middle of the street that cannot move. Number of car accidents that have taken place there because of the cars being parked on the right-hand side. Parked in front of the stop sign in front of the house, which became a suggestion because there's a truck parked, a box truck parked in front of the stop sign.
I think I've been behind all of those trucks at one time or another in my life. I'm on Pearl Street a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chief, is there something about that, the Longwood Place, that makes it particularly a pinch point that doesn't also apply to the southernmost part of Pearl Street? In other words, do you still have the same parking on both sides problem as you go down to, I guess that's Orange Street that cuts across? Yeah, right there. Is there still also a problem where you have parking on both sides at that point, or is that?
I don't know if it seems wider down there, but I don't think we have the problem with people parking down there as much as we do, I think, when the games and everything are going on up in this area.
It might move there as a consequence.
Yeah.
Right, so I agree. Yeah, and the other concern is, like Bill brought up, was we do have a lot of the FI department responding to the calls here at 75.
My question is, would you, it's not a motion, but would you, I guess you'd come back at a future date and expect,
consider
expect
the,
you know,
give him the whole length of it, right?
Yes, Larry.
Larry Gilson, 70 Pearl Street. So we're right across the, from Longwood, the driveway. Their driveway and our driveway is just about right,
right
across from each other. And that point, and I don't disagree with anything you say. As a matter of fact, I do agree with it. This is a larger problem than just, you know, who's right or wrong. So I do want to, you know, let you know that I agree with everything that he's saying. It is very difficult if cars are parking on the east side, on the Longwood side, because they do cut into the road. And so when you have traffic going back and forth, you're almost limited to one lane. So that kind of, I hope that gives you an idea how wide the road is.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, so the problem that I see as the counter is that all the cars are now parking up on the sidewalk. And that
across
really
the street, you mean?
Across the street.
In front of your house.
In front of, yeah, in front of my house. And it really is a problem getting out. So, part of the thing that you're kind of getting at, the reason why some of those traffic jams are there is not just because the cars are parked along one side or the other. It's because you have traffic going both ways. And let's just face it, people are inconsiderate. You know, an ambulance comes by, you think that people should pull over to the side of the road, and they don't do that. Right, so we get all those types of combinations of idiocy that winds up happening. I'm pulling out of my driveway, and I nearly get clipped by someone who doesn't want to stop. And they just go right around me. Now, I can't see them, they can see me. You would think someone would stop. And I'm just fortunate I had a car that had collision warning, so I stopped immediately.
Yep.
That person just swung right around. And we're asking kids to cross that street where that type of activity, that type of bad behavior, I'll call it, exists. So, you know, it's like one side or the other isn't really a great option, but it's also that we're picking up the burden for having a sidewalk.
And so your concern, do I understand your concern then to be that if you further limit, as is proposed here, the parking, it's going to further congest the other side of the street?
Yes.
Rather than move it to Belmont or, you know, wherever. I mean, there is a certain reality to Pearl Street. I mean, it's, you wouldn't think it would be Main Street, but it kind of is. I mean, there's a lot
of
traffic
on it.
That's the oldest road
yeah.
in town, is that correct?
Say that again?
That was the original Main Street to Pearl, is that correct?
It wouldn't surprise me. I mean, it does actually, if you look at it, it makes sense.
It's probably the longest
Main Street
in
Pearl.
Okay.
So it is, and you get a lot of through traffic there. As soon as you get a backup between Main Street and 129, people start going down. They don't go down Belmont as much because they don't see the group there, but they, Pearl is the main road that people take, especially trucks, whether they should go down there or not. And then you get Harrison, which is a little bit more limited. But there is quite
a bit of
traffic.
But it's interesting that Harrison had a similar problem not that many years ago, and they kind of redid what was going on parking over there as well. Yes, Barry?
Chief, was there ever, I mean, I know you solve one problem and create 25 others, but would part of this problem be mitigated if that section of Pearl Street was a one-way?
Our only concern with that would be is where you're coming in.
And I'm not suggesting one way or the other, but just
right.
So make people go kind of go that way so that there's.
You're routing them right into the residential neighborhood, though, which I guess they're cutting through anyway, so.
Which way?
I'm just.
On rush hour?
We haven't, I'll be honest, we haven't done any type of study on it, but we can. We just haven't done anything like that so far.
Here is a first pass, and rather than deal with the flow issue, which is what Barry's poking at, you want to deal with just the obstruction issues.
Right now, it's just way too tight when we're trying to get through this. So we thought the simple solution was to just extending no parking, which is already there on that side, another 185 feet.
With regard to the comments made here today about folks parking on sidewalks or tree lines.
If they park on the sidewalk, we can gladly tag. If that's not an issue at all, just call. I will have a cruiser down there, regularly check it, like we do right now at the end of Bancroft, and gladly there. So if they're on the tree line a little bit, we're going to allow that. But if they're on the sidewalk itself, they're going to get tagged. That's not an issue.
I think it is important to follow what the chief is saying. You got to let them know.
Okay.
I mean, you really do. And we've had other neighbors in other parts of town come in and say, well, you know, the signs are there, but people are still doing it. Well, you got to help the police because they can't be everywhere unless
to
they're alerted.
I didn't know that people are not supposed to park on the sidewalk.
No, they can't park. But it's a public
you
can walk on the sidewalk. It's a $20 fine.
And you've seen that area, though. So when you take a look at the berm, all the way, if I could point out here, at least from here all the way down to here, you can see where the edge of the road, where the berm is actually cut, and it cuts underneath the road. So, you know, you can solve the problem by having people not park on the sidewalk, but what you start to do is deteriorate the edge of the road, which is just going to increase cost because sooner or later that's going to have to be repaired.
Well, I think at a certain point, I mean, I do hear what you're saying, Larry, and I am sympathetic to it. This thing, I think, you know, kind of the combination, it's a difficult situation that's going to need to be worked with. And I, you know, my suspicion is that, you know, the chief is making a recommendation here and is going to stay fluid about how it unfolds. I mean, the idea that you can help him help you and your neighbors by letting, when people are on a sidewalk, they're just not supposed to be there. And, you know, a month or so of enforcement and you're in season for that.
We were down at Morton during the playoffs of Babe Ruth, and after the first game when Chiefs folks were tagging people, by the second game there was nobody parked where they weren't supposed to be.
A little bit of enforcement goes a long way, but you need to help them. That's what I think. And it seems like this is the proposition seems in my mind to be a safety issue. Both points are safety issues. I think we got to get one going and see if we can work on the other. I think signs routing them to a wider thoroughfare is probably a good idea. Now, would recreation do that, Bob? Would they need to come to us to do that?
Yeah, they could because it's a field. We lease it, so it's a little different, but we'll figure it out.
Okay.
DPW.
Does that need to be in the motion tonight or no?
No.
So, in the interest of time, because we are running a little behind, are there more questions or comments?
Well, just a clarification. So, you know, the berm area, again, I've got a concern about that because it is deteriorated quite a bit at this point. Is that part of not parking on the sidewalk, or
no,
is
if,
that?
So, if the berm is attached to the tree limit, correct? That's what's on the other side of the berm, then the sidewalk?
Now, help me understand the tree line.
Yeah, the tree lawn is a little grassy area.
The tree lawn is,
Yeah.
So if they park on the tree lawn, no, we're not going to tag. But if they park on the actual sidewalk itself, they're going to get a tag. for what's happened to the berm, well, if it makes the creek, the road be a little bit wider to get cars by, you know, for my opinion, for a safety issue, I'm okay with that, as long as they're not blocking the view, or your driveway, you know, obviously, no, any issue with the end of your driveway, call us.
Gentlemen, you were saying something about the recreation department, if you speak with John Fudo, he is well aware of this problem, he's been working with myself, the wife, and some of the other neighbors.
Yep.
So, if you talk to Mr. Fudo, can you fill in on?
And I know he's, because I've been liaison there for many years, I know you're right about that, so, another.
Yeah, hi, Jeff Anderson, 24 Vale Road, and a U-10 soccer coach that coached here all season, and I completely agree with everything you're saying, to the point where I will, next year, if I have the option, I will refuse to practice there, because it's impossible to park, it is absolutely a safety issue, you've got 10-year-old kids kicking soccer balls all over the place, there's a 5-foot buffer between the field and the street.
Mm-hmm.
Balls are going in the street, kids start running after them, I've got to chase them to stop them. So that's a big problem in and of itself, not to mention the fact we've got towns coming from all over the place.
Yeah.
Stoneham, Medford, a bunch of other ones, Melrose, and they feel kind of unwelcome when they come here because there's nowhere to park. They pull in here, there's a big sign that says you can't park here unless you're going to
the residences.
To the residence. So, I mean, not to sound drastic, but I would stop using this field. I know land in this town is impossible to come by, but if we could carve out a piece of Memorial Park and build a U-10 soccer field there, I don't want to play here anymore. It's become that bad.
Real quick.
Yes.
I'll be quick, Mr. Chairman. I agree, Jeff, with you 100%. That's actually a thought I was just hearing. As everyone's going round and round talking about this, it feels like we're putting a Band-Aid on a larger issue, which is, you know, maybe this is not a good field for us to be using. I don't understand. As Jeff mentioned, field space is a premium in this town, certainly. But we lease this space currently, Bob?
I think it might have been a 99-year lease.
Yeah.
Okay.
At some point.
So, you know, I'd certainly make the recommendation. I'm for this, what the chief's presented us tonight. This makes perfect sense from a public safety standpoint. Moving forward, though, I think we really do need to review not utilizing this field in the future and maybe getting into
some space
elsewhere.
Well, you know, the recreation
elsewhere.
Committee is one of our advisory committees,
right.
And I think what we
that.
Can do is
yeah.
is move that out to them. You know, if we're leasing this thing, maybe it becomes a small field and half of it becomes a parking lot. I mean, I don't know whether we even could do that, but I think that's at the issue at hand. There's a proposal in this hearing. Further public discussion on this hearing.
One last quickie.
Yes, John.
Is there any other means of egress onto the property, Chief, or is it only on the Pearl Street? In other words, can you get from Belmont onto the field or Cherkessett Road?
It's all private owned.
Yeah, we go through Bill's backyard, didn't they?
I hate to say it, but you wouldn't be the first.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Motion.
We got to close the hearing, yep.
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on increasing the number, the no parking on Eastley side in front of 75 Pearl Street from 100 feet to 285 feet.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor closing the hearing? 5-0.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve amending Article 12.1 of the Town of Reading Traffic and Parking Regulations to prohibit parking on the Eastley side in front of 75 Pearl Street for approximately 285 feet.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? I'd encourage you, Larry, to make those calls when that, it won't take long. The enforcement will quickly solve at least the sidewalk problem.
Yeah, they will. I'm actually really concerned about the berm, though, too.
Well, I think we just have to see what goes on. We're going to refer this out to the Recreation Committee for
study.
Can
Public Works do anything, Bob, in terms of backfilling that?
Yeah, our engineers can look at it. Their general concern would be drainage. So, you know, if it was a steep hill or a hill,
right,
that'd be
right.
a whole different
the
issue.
Drainage is on the other side of the street.
Yeah, but they mandate curbs if there's a certain strain, drain water, drainage issue. It probably wouldn't be.
I'd love to see a curb,
yeah.
I wouldn't even mind going right up to the sidewalk and cutting into it.
Yeah.
Well, it sounds like looking into getting the cars not even parking there in the first place is going to be the best option. So we'll certainly have the Recreation Department look into that.
Okay, time for another hearing.
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on June 21st, 2016, in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. No bus access beyond house number 230 on Bancroft Avenue. copy of the proposed document regarding this topic, et cetera, et cetera.
Good evening. Okay, so this is the follow-up from our last time here on Bancroft Ave. We just don't want to allow buses that we have to be able to back up in an unsafe direction from the end of Bancroft. 230 is actually, I think, this house here. We're just looking to stop them from the dead end part of coming and having the backup.
Yep.
Yep.
So, there used to be a bus sign, no bus sign 8 years ago. I think it was not supposed to be there, but we couldn't find it in the parking traffic rules and regulations. But we'd like to actually put it in there and do it right.
I think that house is 104 Hart Shore, and the 230 is probably next to it.
It's, I think it's right here, right? Or this one? It's one of these, right? Yeah, that's on Hart Shore.
Yeah, yeah. I thought you meant.
So the entirety of that dead end, that cul-de-sac, is off limits.
Bus free now.
Bus free, that's what we'd like.
Yeah, so they have, if they actually do come down that street rather than drop them off at the field house or...
Spikes come out of the road.
Yeah, they have to turn onto Hart Shore and leave the neighborhood essentially.
The new signs which have been ordered, I understand, from recreation to show people the wayfinder around.
Okay. Questions from the board?
It's a no-brainer.
Nope.
Yep.
This is an easy one.
This is, I think, what we've asked you to do and then what the neighbors ask you to do. I think this is right on the money. Public comment?
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing restricting bus access beyond house number 230 on Bancroft Ave.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor closing the hearing? 5-0.
Move the Board of Selectmen amend Article 12.1 of the Town of Reading Traffic and Parking Regulations to prevent bus access beyond 230 Bancroft Ave.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
Okay, another one?
Okay, another hearing.
To the inhabitants of the Town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading will hold a public hearing on June 21st, 2016 in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. No parking on the northerly side of Charles Street between Dana.
Dana Road and Boswell Road.
Dana Road and Boswell Road. Between 8 a.m. and 3:30 p.m. on Monday through Friday. Is that right?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
It's across from the fuel.
Yep.
I think there's another piece to that.
And
too.
Enact Article 5.4.4, additional time restriction on Charles Street.
You're on again, Chief.
Currently, right now, as it is today, it's 8 to 9:30 and 2:30 to 3:30 is the same restrictions that are already there.
Mm-hmm.
We're just looking to extend it. We've spoken with Kiln, we've spoken to several of the neighbors. The reason is that there's additional half-time kindergartens coming in out of school, and when that happens, the kids are trying to cross to their parents' cars. It's very distracting, it's very difficult to see coming out of either of these streets. That's why they had put those rules and regulations into effect years ago. So we're just looking to extend it now from the whole time that school's...
Yeah, because there's different hours for school now.
Correct. That's
so,
the only reason we're here, but
yeah.
For this. It's the same side, everything's the same except for just extending it for the whole day instead of from part of the day.
Yep.
Chief, parking includes standing, stopping, there's...
Correct, he's
no
the
vehicle.
Only one waiting over there or anything else.
Okay.
We've been moving them along during the hours we can.
All right.
It's during the middle of the day when the kindergartens are getting out that it becomes an issue.
Okay. So it clears the visibility, it clears
absolutely.
The... Any questions from the board? Questions from the public? Barry, you're on.
I move that the Board of Selectmen in it.
Close the hearing.
We're closing.
5E.
Yeah. Oh, close the hearing. It's not on there. Oh, I'm sorry. Close the hearing on additional time restrictions on parking on Charles Street between Dana Road and Boswell Road between the hours of 8 a.m. and 3:30 p.m. Monday through Friday, and enacting Article 5.4.4K of the Town of Reading Traffic Rules Regulations.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor closing the hearing? 5-0. You're on, Barry.
Move that the Board of Selectmen amend Article 12 of the Town of Reading Traffic and Parking Regulations to replace 5.4.4D to 5.4.4K by adding the following. Pursuant to Article 5.4.4K, parking shall be prohibited on the northerly side of Charles Street between Dana Road and Boswell Road between the hours of 8 a.m. and 3:30 p.m. on Monday through Friday.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? 5-0. Okay.
And then, isn't there another piece of this?
Yep.
No. Another hearing.
Yep.
There's another motion following that hearing.
Move that the Board of Selectmen
right.
enact Article 5.4.4K additional time restriction to include No person shall park a vehicle from 8 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. on Monday through Friday on any of the streets or parts of the streets to which this article has been applied, as listed under Article 12 of the Town of Reading Traffic and Parking by regulations.
Discussion?
Yes.
I've
never heard, maybe I just don't recall, the difference between amend and enact. Why is an amendment just enough to... Chief?
I don't know.
Got a new chief?
New town council.
It's fine. I didn't mean to put anyone on the spot.
Sorry.
I've never had to enact and then, or amend and then enact. Double secret probation.
Yes.
Don't just amend and enact it.
I think we were thinking because it was already, the hours were already
maybe
so far, 8 to 9:30 and then 2:30 to 3:30. Now it's to amend those hours.
So we amend it and then we're going to enact the...
We really mean business.
And then we're going to take action.
This is
then we're going to take
serious.
Action.
We're going to do this twice. Okay.
Discussion.
Any other material questions? hearing none. We have a motion, is that right? We have a second?
We do.
We do? We have no more discussion? We have a vote.
Oh.
All in favor? 5-0.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Chief.
Thank you very much, Chief.
Okay.
Okay.
Next hearing.
Please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading will hold a public hearing on June 21st, 2016 at 7:50 p.m. in the Selectmen's Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. An application for an all-alcohol restaurant liquor license for Chipotle Mexican Grill of Colorado, LLC, DBA Chipotle Mexican Grill, 46 Walkers Brook Road, Reading, Mass. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing by email prior to 6 p.m. on June 21st, 2016 to townmanager@cireading.ma.us by order of Robert Will Asher, Town Manager.
Okay, and do we have representatives from Chipotle Mexican Grill?
Yes.
Okay.
Good evening.
You're on.
Thank you. I'm Matt Fogelman. I'm an attorney, office in Newton. I represent Chipotle all across the Commonwealth. Been involved with about 20 different towns getting licenses for them. With me is Shane Wilson. He's the proposed, he's the manager, but proposed general manager for the purposes of the license before you, for the board. Happy to take any questions. Chipotle is a very well-known company based out of Colorado, restaurants all across the state and internationally. About 20 in the Commonwealth, been open in Reading for a couple of months, about 2 months. Things are going well, off to a good start. They're very happy to be here in town. I hope the town is happy to have us here. Again, happy to take any questions. Or I can provide more of an overview as well, whatever the board prefers.
Well, let's start with some questions and then we'll see if we need to keep rolling.
Mr. Wilson or Councilor Fogelman, a couple questions. So I've been to many Chipotles, but alcohol is a new thing for me. How do you make the call which sites get it, which sites don't?
Oh, that's a good question. It is the company's preference, both in the Commonwealth and in general, to have alcohol at its restaurants. It is part of the model, if you will. In most of the restaurants in the Commonwealth, do have them, not all. A couple of exceptions to that are, there are towns where they're capped, their quota, particularly in Boston and elsewhere.
Sure.
And the going rate for licenses these days, it can be upwards of $200,000-$400,000. Obviously, Chipotle could afford that if they wanted to. They're not a mom and pop shop, but it is not a huge part of their business. So they have made the decision that they're not going to spend that kind of money on a license. It just doesn't make sense given the volume of their sales. You have a certain restaurant where people are going to be sitting down and ordering steaks and fish and having a two-hour meal. Obviously, those types of restaurants have to have it, right? It's hard for them to stay in business. Chipotle has made the decision that they're okay with not having it if it means spending that type of money. That being said, when they can get it, they do like to. And that is generally when they're available.
Makes perfect sense.
It's enough of their business that they like to have it, but it's not crucial where they need it in order to survive.
And Bob, this application is for all alcohol, not just beer and wine? I believe so.
Yes.
I believe it is.
Let me explain what they do. Part of the model, and this is across the board nationwide, they only do beer and margaritas. So in order to do beer and margaritas, you need a full liquor license.
Right.
Like some towns, there's only beer and wine available, then they'll go for that, and they'll just do the beer and not the margaritas. When there's a full license available, again, part of the model is they like to get it, but it's only beer and margaritas. No other hard alcohol, no wine.
That explains it.
So that's, if you're going into a Chipotle, you're only going to get a beer and margarita, or if there's no margs, then you're just going to get the beer. And that's it.
Thank you. Yes, Barry.
So, Mr. Wilson, you'd be the person who's the general manager, kind of on the shop floor day to day.
Yes.
So Chipotle obviously is a huge corporation. Who do you report to? Do you report to Colorado, or is there a ownership group that owns your restaurant, or is there an ownership group that owns a series of restaurants? I just kind of would like to
chain
explain.
Of command.
Yeah.
You can go ahead, and I can chime in too.
So it's corporate owned, it's not franchise. But there is a hierarchy in terms of leadership that oversees the immediate area, the region, as well as the entire company. It's a company of over 2,000 plus stores. But I myself report to an area manager. My area manager reports to a regional director, and then the regional director is someone that would communicate with our officers in Colorado.
So you're one of how many that report to an area manager? Do you know?
One of six.
One of six. Okay.
How often do you see
them? I just saw them today. But I see
on a regular, kind of going forward basis?
Probably once a week, twice a week.
So you've got an extra pair of hands available to you and to advise and and provide corporate counsel at least.
Yes, of course.
So.
Oh, absolutely. There are multiple chains
that
go from area all the way to Colorado to me to whoever.
Yeah, and I think we're asking these kind of questions. This is a very different kind of license for us.
Sure.
I mean, I realize that Chipotle is a different type of fast food, if you will. It's certainly very different than the burger places, but it's also very different than, we'll say, maybe a Chili's. I mean, it's,
sure.
So it's a little bit different. I think this is what's prompting the question. At least these are questions I'd be interested in as well.
Absolutely, much as for folks watching on TV that may have the same questions, right?
Yeah.
Sure. Absolutely. I mean, it is, like I said, it's part of the model. The reason that they like to do it is, when you go to a Chipotle, just like if you go to a Hilton, you want to have you're used to a certain experience. And if you go to a Hilton in Boston, you want it to be the same as when you go to the Hilton in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of the same idea. It's a customer who likes going there, who expects going there, who wants to go in California or in Boston or New York or whatever, has a kind of the same experience.
Yep.
The managers are trained to monitor the floor carefully, also assistant managers. They know who's buying the drink, who's drinking the drink. you have to buy food. You can't just go in there and get a drink.
It doesn't sound like it's designed as a watering hole.
It's not. And people don't sort of hang out and let's have one more. It's just not that.
Yeah.
You go in, you get your...
You order your food,
you get
order
your burrito,
a margarita,
you want to have a beer,
beer,
you sit down,
yeah.
and you leave in half an hour, 20
yeah.
minutes.
So you deny somebody coming and just wanting to buy a drink?
Yes. We do. And people don't do that, though.
Were you doing a lot of turns business? I assume most folks are on site for 45 minutes max and then on their way, as opposed to an evening out.
Absolutely.
Is there any different behavior on the part of people when they come in, where they tend to get more rowdy, or they know they're going somewhere else, so they're kind of getting juiced up for the, what's coming later? Do you see any of that kind of behavior?
Not to my
experience. Send the Chili's.
No. You really, it's just not that type
here
of
here we go.
Never seen one of these,
this
so
is
so
going to break down fast. I can see that.
The chair lost control of the
yes. Barry, did you? I know you had a question.
I did have a,
The price point is good. It's, it's all fresh meat and everything. So, a lot of families, because it's a nice price.
Look, it doesn't seem from your comments and just reading the body English here that there's a real concern, but we've always taken a really strong view out of the gate around service and service to minors and tips training, and where there have been transgressions, we deal with them pretty quickly and usually very strongly up front. And, it's kind of just a heads up. That's the way it's going to be if there's a transgression. So, going in, it's just the way we roll.
Understood, understood. And, you know, we take it very seriously. The company takes it very seriously. And of course, there have been over the history of 15 years with 2,000 restaurants, you're going to have, you know, it's not perfect.
No one's perfect.
But if you look at the number of restaurants they have and the number of violations they've received, it's a pretty low percentage.
Yep. Well, it is a the regular habit of our police department, as directed by our chief, that you're going to get visited and somebody's going to try to pop you. And we want you to stop them.
Yep.
I mean, that's going to be the goal, and we do that, you know, so that you can. It's really not to be at odds with you; it's to help you stay alert.
Of course.
You know, because what Mr. Arena says is very true. I mean, we do have a rather serious history of, you know, taking this very seriously. So, Barry, I know you have.
Yeah, I just had one question. So. You had mentioned that in your stores in Massachusetts, you know, you want to obviously kind of keep the, you know, the experience level the same from store to store, but then in some communities you don't have a liquor license.
Right.
But you've opened anyway.
Correct.
And either the cost is prohibitive or they ran out of licenses. It was sort of the reason why.
Yeah, well,
the
two go hand in hand, right?
Well, we, you know, we also
run
too,
out,
right.
Yeah.
We also too have a limited number of licenses, not and so my question is, so you opened under, you know, sort of not with the expectation of getting, you opened anyway, it wasn't like you were taking over, you know, buying a an existing license, taking over a restaurant, so you opened up, you know, without a an all liquor license, with the expectation of operating anyway, you know, if you didn't get it, would you still operate in the same capacity? I'm just kind of curious about, because you opened up, I mean, you went in, you know, hoping you get it, but not, it wasn't guaranteed before you made the, before the corporation at least made the commitment
right.
to break ground and open and rent.
That's true. It's a tough question for me to answer, Mr. Berman. I mean, if you don't give us a license, are we going to close? I mean, probably not. No.
Okay.
I mean, I would say not. Do we want to have the ability to serve our customers? Yes, we do. You know, do our customers enjoy having that option? They definitely do. We know that. I mean, that's been sort of proven in studies that they've done and surveys and so forth. I don't know. I mean, we certainly,
I'm
you know, they certainly are interested in
this
having
is a
one.
Unique,
they,
this
they,
is a unique sort of situation here,
yeah.
That usually when a restaurant comes in, they're purchasing an already existing license.
Right.
So
right.
This
and
is
it's kind of
a little
required
different.
Almost.
Right.
Yeah.
And
so no, I would say we're different.
Right.
But, you
okay.
know, like I said, they do like it. They do want it. It's beneficial to their customers. I think people in the community, you know, your people in Reading and want to go in, I think they enjoy that opportunity. You know? I don't know if that answers the question
no.
exactly.
Kevin?
Yeah, just a couple real quick questions. Mr. Wilson, you have experience in the past with all alcohol licenses?
Yes.
Okay. How long have you worked in the business that had one?
Chipotle itself, I've worked for the company for almost 3 years.
Okay.
In
New Hampshire.
In New Hampshire, as well as Vermont.
Okay, so you've not only worked in with all alcohol licenses, you've worked in Chipotle's that had one.
Yes.
So you're kind of used to the routine and how it operates.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, that's good. The other question I had real quickly, just was glad the chief's here. I didn't see any recommendation in our packet.
Page 18 tonight.
Yeah, it's here.
Okay, that's, I'm
sure.
looking on
yeah,
my computer.
Yeah, it's clear.
All right. That's my only other question I have.
You see how quick he is? Just notice that page.
I'm good, thank you.
The only question I have remaining, for me at least, is the spot your store is in, I think is a great spot for the store, but I think you're gonna need to stay on top of your vendors that are delivering. You know, wine supply, well, you're not using wine, but you know, liquor suppliers are notorious for, they pull up to the front door and they run in. That's gonna be the last place you want that to happen.
We do have a back door access that we
use. I know you've got the back set up for it, and I just caution you that, you know, the spot where your store is, I think you're the manager on site, you're gonna be able to manage that vendor from the beginning, and I think it's important you do that. I just pass that along as a thought. Because obviously not only would it be bad for your business, but that particular place, high traffic, lot going on, lot coming and, I mean, there's a lot coming and going all around you there, so. Using the back is really important.
Coordinate with the vendor as well, just best times to deliver, you know, definitely when we're open.
Yeah.
When we're not open, and that way it can just be coordinated. So that way there's just little
yep.
to no, no variance in that.
Well.
And it's pretty much just beer that they're delivering.
Yeah.
Because the
everything else is a mix.
Basically. I mean,
yeah.
they make it better.
Yeah. Anything else from members of the board?
No.
Members of the public, yes.
Yes, Dave Tuttle, 27 Heather Drive. Just a question, the Chipotle frequently does a catering business as well, corporate catering, and I presume that the all does not cover anything other than on-premise.
Correct. Yeah, we, so alcohol will not leave the front doors.
Okay.
Everything has to stay within the building. We do have a patio, but there's going to be a sign that's posted, and we let every customer know they're not allowed to leave the four walls with an open beverage. They have to finish up before they leave.
Excellent. Thank you.
Problem?
Yes.
Next to FEMA, South Street. I'm just curious what size the beverages are and whether a customer can order multiple beverages with their meal.
Sure. So two drink maximum. So that's either two beers or two margaritas. We offer Sousa or Patron margaritas. With varying price points. The beers are always bottled, not canned. And the margaritas are in a 16-ounce like clear plastic cup, and that's it. We don't offer like shots or anything like that. They have to get a mixed margarita to the recipe, and that's it.
So it's a 16-ounce, you can get two 16-ounce beverages for your 30-minute stay.
Yeah, two 16-ounce beverages. So what is the alcohol, you know, what is that one shot?
I want to say that it is one shot.
Per margarita.
Yeah.
So I think I'm hearing your question as, you know, can you gas up here?
Yeah.
And it sounds like you can have, it sounds like it's a two drink kind of thing. That's what it's,
but you have to,
do I have that?
You have to purchase food, yes. Yeah. So you couldn't.
Yeah, so you purchase food and you're allowed to have two drinks.
So one drink at a time, two drinks during your stay. If you so choose to come back up and get a bag of chips and you want to order another drink, then we'll allow it. But we don't sell.
Got it. And so the maximum is two?
Yes.
And you have to reorder food to get the second?
Correct. Unless you're with a partner or significant other, then you can order two
right.
for them. But it's not, you can't order two for yourself and then sit down.
Yep. Other questions
and
from the public?
The truth is that we found that, I mean, I know it's sort of me just saying this, but they have found, people just don't do that. I mean, not 0%, but I mean, that's generally not what people are going there to do, you know?
Well,
gas up. I mean, I've never heard that phrase before, but I understand it. And, you know, it's...
Old baseball guy.
Yeah.
You know, we just haven't found that to be the type of thing that people are trying to do.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well, the good news about every license in Reading is it's annually renewable. So, you know, I mean, that's the beauty of it. So, are there other questions from the public or from the board?
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on the application for an all-alcohol restaurant liquor license for Chipotle Mexican Grill, 46 Walkers Brook Drive.
Second.
All, any discussion? All those in favor closing the hearing? 5-0.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the application for an all-alcohol restaurant liquor license for Chipotle Mexican Grill, Colorado, LLC, DBA Chipotle Mexican Grill, 46 Walkers Brook Drive, Reading. For a term expiring December 31st, 2016, subject to the following conditions. All bylaws, rules, regulations of the Town of Reading and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts shall be followed and subject to a satisfactory inspection of the establishment by the town manager or his designee.
Second.
Discussion?
Just one quick question.
Yes.
Bob, if this is granted, how many more do we have left?
I think it's seven. We lost a vendor, right? I think that leaves seven.
We got one came
back.
Oh,
that's right. One came back.
It's in bankruptcy, but it will come back.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. That's
got
all.
It. All those in favor? Opposed? Good luck.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
When would you expect to start, given?
So
trucks on the way.
Gassing up right now.
Gassing up as we speak.
Right after the meeting.
Well, so it goes up to the state, as you know. So you guys will send it up there.
Internal planning, what is that?
Well, I mean, but, you know, as soon as the state sends it back here and you guys are ready to issue it, you know, once we get it, then.
It sounds like you're getting some dinner plans ready.
They'll order.
I might, I'm really hungry now, I'm talking about margaritas.
Yeah, so I mean, you know, as soon as, when the town makes it available, then, yeah, I mean, I don't think it takes them long to order whatever they need.
No.
Good, thank you.
All right.
And do I get this? Or someone else?
Yeah, right there.
Right, and so I didn't get all the green cards back yet, I've got a couple of them, but I did mail them off, so when I get them back, should I follow up and mail them in?
Yeah.
Thank you.
And should I send them to anyone in particular?
You can just send them to the office of the town manager, it's good.
Okay.
Thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Thanks, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Good luck.
Thank you, good luck.
Okay, and we're running a little behind schedule, but CPDC is here. Jeff, do you need to call yourselves to order, are you?
Yeah, let's call this meeting of the CPDC to order.
Okay.
All right, do you have a point?
To introduce your committee?
Sure, well, good evening, everybody. My name is Jeff Hanson, I'm the chairman of the CPDC. I'm joined by Dave Tuttle, Nick Safina, John Weston, and that's the four of us tonight. We're missing Karen, she wasn't able to make it. But we wanted to take this opportunity to kind of revisit with all of you and provide an update on the zoning work that the CPDC has been doing in preparation for November town meeting and even beyond. So what's the best way to through this right?
Just nod and I'll.
Okay.
I'll
is this the pointer?
Yeah.
You pointed at him, he'll click.
Yeah.
Actually, let's go ahead.
Don't point it at Bob, he'll crash the plane.
There's a slide missing.
What are you looking for?
It's this slide.
Do you have this? Is it on the website?
That's all right. I can kind of pass this around.
Show.
Yeah, this might be a good way to kind of set the stage. So this should be a familiar slide. This is the slide that we presented to town meeting the last couple of years, or I guess the last couple of go-rounds.
Oh, right, yeah.
We keep adding columns to it as work gets completed. So this area over here keeps shrinking because luckily.
There it is right there, it's hidden. The slide's hidden, right now it's unhide.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, and then if you go full screen with it, would be good.
Unhide slide. Right mouse the slide and unhide it.
There we go.
In no time did my fingers leave my hand.
I don't believe it for a minute.
So this is really all the work that we've done since the Zoning Advisory Committee came into existence in the late 2012 timeframe. Our first article was presented in 2013, November of, and most of the items were passed. Then we took another series of articles in September 2014, again November 2014. Most recently, November 2015, we had the updated purpose, the updated aquifer protection district, the commercial communication structures, and also we continued to consolidate some definitions. So we've completed a lot of work to get our bylaw simpler, cleaner, easier to use, and more up to date. But there's still some big hit items that we really need to address in the near future. Now, when we came out in November 2015, we had a certain set of priorities that we had discussed as a team, as a committee, and we felt were the right ones to proceed with. And that's that top kind of quadrant right here, this top square. So we had parking, planned residential development, PRD, planned unit development, PUD, and then minor updates. And the minor updates is meant to kind of encapsulate any changes that would arise after we've gotten some traction from using the updated bylaw. But then some things started happening. Some facts started being presented to us that made us rethink what our priorities are. And I'll get to, these are ultimately what our priorities are, but let's talk a little bit about, if you would mind going to the next slide, what those driving factors were that made us rethink it. The number one item was the release of the economic development plan, which really put a lot of emphasis on expanding the downtown growth, the downtown smart growth district. It focused primarily on the commuter rail station, a lot of the area around Green Street. There was also you know, the desire to facilitate mixed-use infill development, helping Reading meet its economic development goals as well as regional demand. And then also develop and implement a comprehensive parking strategy. This piece we're less focused on, although that is a big item, and I'll talk about that briefly. But really, this piece right here, it rang clear to us that this was something we needed to think about. So that's the first recommendation. The second one came from town council. Our signed bylaw really was out of date following a Supreme Court ruling that prevented us from limiting content within the sign bylaw. Do I have that right?
Can't regulate the content.
So you can't regulate the content within our sign bylaw. So he really recommended that we take a look at it and get that updated. So these two factors, primarily the downtown smart growth district, expanded that, and town council's recommendation gave us pause to rethink what our priorities are. If you want to go to the next slide. So this is our proposed zoning amendments. I'll start at the top. We've got site plan review and then other amendments. These two kind of fall into that category of we've got probably 6 months to a year, maybe a little bit more, of using our new bylaw. And we've noticed some areas that need to be refined and tweaked. So for site plan review, we're amending it to really adjust some of the criteria that we have so we can capture some other planning implications that that may have an impact on abutters and things of that sort. We've actually seen situations where there's impacts that we really hadn't even considered, and they ended up not even coming before us. So we decided that it made sense to review the site plan review criteria and also obviously continue to make it more applicant friendly. We've got other amendments here as well, a number of small items. Generally, we're adding pet grooming and allow it by right in certain parts of the town. This is to contrast with a kennel, because pet grooming and kennel, we only had kennel in our bylaw, in our table of uses. We felt the need to add pet grooming. A table of accessory uses to allow parking and garaging of more than one commercial vehicle by special permit. Special home occupation, parameters for approval, and then accessory buildings and structures. So really small items in the grand scheme of things that came up as feedback that we wanted to address.
What were you thinking of as special home occupations? What are some examples that fall into that?
That's a good example. I know we've got a few. I'm going to look to Julie to help with that one.
Sure. So like if right now we allow someone to have a home occupation if they're a resident of the house and they can't have like any employees, not one, and they can't have any, there can't be any like visible indication that the structure's being used for anything besides, a single family use. So the special home occupation would allow someone to teach music lessons and have, a couple kids come a couple times a week and, they're dropped off and it's not a huge visible impact. But we've been hearing that, the bylaw is kind of limiting because we only allow, home occupations by residents of the home. So someone can't even have like a tech business where they have one guy come and help with IT from the home. And I thought personally that if we allowed it by a special permit process, that would give the CPDC leverage to add conditions, to deny it if it's not something that they think is appropriate. So we have a number of parameters to go along with.
I guess I'm still confused. So if I own the home and I do taxes, say, and I don't have a shingle out front, that's fine. I suppose the same is true if I do music lessons and I own the home and I do piano lessons, which you don't want to hear me. But you're describing a third party who may not be a resident, may not own the property, but uses it for the purpose of conducting a business, but it's a private home?
So it would be the resident, and then they could have like one employee.
I see. You can add an employee.
Or they could have something that is a little bit of a visual, like so a mother comes and drops off her son for a music lesson. So it's a little more traffic than like maybe normally would be
higher
generated.
Intensive use, I see.
But it's
like
nothing excessive.
And
the limits are pretty strict as well. There's not as strict as the current bylaw.
Is there a signage aspect to the special home occupation as well, or is it still no signage?
I mean, that's up to the board, but I would say no.
Okay.
Typically, it's no visible indication that it's being used for anything but.
So, Julie, what about like a home daycare, where you might have, the owner of the house runs the daycare, 6-7 kids get dropped off, and they have, a couple of aides that work with them in the home daycare. Is that, I know that's regulated maybe differently, but
yeah.
What about the, is that in our actual zoning form, does it address home daycare as a specific use?
It's a separate use, and it falls under a separate regulatory.
Yeah, that's got its own, its whole. So, but to John's point, somebody's doing taxes, and during tax season, they bring a second person in because it's tax season. And so now you've got an employee that comes in and parks, and what you're saying is now you can make provision for that.
Right.
Whereas now, if we knew about it, we would have to tell them to stop.
Right.
Because we really don't allow for it at all.
This is gonna be fun at town meeting.
And a commercial vehicle is a vehicle with a commercial plate, not a vehicle of a certain weight or size, true? It's not the vehicle, it's the registration of the vehicle.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a separate regulation for vehicles over 10,000 pounds.
Over 10,000.
Oh, it's weight driven.
There are two, there's this is separate from the one that regulates the heavy vehicles.
I see.
Alright.
Okay.
So we've got sign, site plan review, other amendments, we've got the sign bylaw, which again, town council recommended strongly that we take a hard look at and bring it into compliance with the Supreme Court ruling, which prohibits regulating for content. And while we were doing that, there was a big effort to really simplify it, streamline it, add graphics into it. We looked at it last night and it really looks outstanding, especially compared to what we had. I think it's gonna make the users of the bylaw a lot happier, being able to understand what our regulations are.
Did you guys roll your own, or did you start with kind of a peer product that you tried to tailor?
We're full of euphemisms in this place.
No, we started with our own. I mean, Nick, do you wanna give a kind of a brief update on, he led the work group on that.
We looked at our own, and we looked at some model codes that are written up by the International Municipal Lawyers Association, if that makes any sense, International Municipal. We looked at their model code, and we took some advice from town council, and we changed ours because we felt that that captured everything we wanted, and then we streamlined that.
Okay.
These changes are all to bring it into compliance with the Reed decision.
Yep.
And we've clarified some things. We have not made changes that change the regulation.
Nor do we
think that's a next step.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
To your point about town meeting, signs can become pretty controversial pretty quickly, so we want to make that clear.
Get the
this is all about bringing it to compliance,
yeah.
Cleaning it up, and no regulations have been changed.
Right. So you can it's strictly a compliance move.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
You
I think that's wise.
You can still regulate size and location and materials, right? But not content.
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
Are you planning on bringing all this up in November?
Well, we'll get to that. Right now, just to give you a little heads up on, we're planning to do site plan review, these other amendments, and the sign bylaw. Downtown zoning, we're going to recommend to push that until April 2017. And we'll explain why in a second.
Yes, Dan.
Very briefly, the changes, just kind of this overlay of zoning that the state is passing here, how's that going to affect us? Will that necessitate we pass some bylaw changes?
Yeah, so we've talked to town council about the pending legislation at the state,
mm-hmm.
and town council has advised us to not even spend any time looking at it,
okay.
because it's kind of like Groundhog Day. We've been in this movie
yeah.
time and time
yeah.
again. And rather than spend a lot of time anticipating what the legislature might do, he said it's best to just wait. Let's see if anything gets passed, and then he'll give us some directive after that.
Do we have a channel for input to this process at all? Or not?
I talked to Senator Lewis a week and a half ago.
Mm-hmm.
He indicated it was not going
to
pass this session through
oh,
both
right,
bodies,
the House did.
But that the House would undoubtedly pick up where the Senate left
okay.
off in the next session, and he wants to come in and probably with our two House reps understand
yep.
what we've already done, because
yep.
He wasn't aware of the detail. We made some changes, and just from some of my comments said you're perhaps more progressive than the bill we're looking at.
Oh.
So we do need to have a better dialogue. I wish that they had reached out to us in the past, but nonetheless,
right.
it's a year off from being done.
Okay, that's good.
But it could supersede any and all changes we've made. You know, they do have the authority to do that. That's the scary part. So we definitely want to drag those three parties in here.
Okay.
And make them know at least what we have and what we intend to change.
Thanks.
All right, so then the last item is downtown zoning. We want to build upon the work and the input that was given to us through the economic development planning process. And we also felt that it was important to look beyond just mixed use and consider other zoning mechanisms, such as maybe historic districts or sub-district regulations. And I'll talk a little bit more about that, especially as it applies to the district that was recommended within the economic development plan. So,
are we coming back to that?
Yeah, well, absolutely. Yeah, we'll spend some time
good.
On that. So these two really came out of the work of just getting feedback from people that have used the bylaw. These two came out of recommendations, again, to town council. and this one came out of the economic development plan. This was all vetted, this revised set of priorities was all vetted in a meeting in February 2016, a public forum where we presented it, and we really didn't get any pushback whatsoever. People were generally in agreement. They thought that the rationale to reprioritize made sense. Let's move to the next slide. So on April 11th, 2016, the CPDC organized a public forum. We had over 80 people attend, and it was really well facilitated, excellent engagement, excellent presentation, and most importantly, there were a number of, it was very interactive, there were a number of maps out there at different tables where people could go ahead and indicate in a very structured way what priorities they felt were important as far as zoning goes. We identified five specific areas that we felt could be considered. This area along kind of abuts South Main, or this part of Main Street, and then this part of the existing 40R. We've got Woburn Street over here. We've got this area along Lincoln Street. So we looked at all of these areas, which kind of surrounded the existing 40R. And we asked people, what do you think should be our priorities for zoning expansion and the like? And generally, what we learned was people felt very strongly about this corridor right here, which brings us from just south of the train tracks all the way up to, is that Woburn Street? No, not Woburn Street.
Green.
Haven Street, yeah, it's Haven Street. So that was the first area that people felt strongly about. And the second area that they felt strongly about was this corridor right here. I have to be honest, I think a lot of the favoritism towards this group is probably driven by the 40B that's going in right around here. I think people were just nervous about that. I don't think that this has a lot of traction just yet. I think there needs to be a little bit more work done with the 40B for people to understand how this could be used. This was an area that was recommended in the economic development plan. We absolutely agree that it's worth considering. However, I talked about kind of sub-district regulations. Throwing a 40R on top of this area right here is, I don't want to say risky, but it's a little presumptuous. Only because you've got Green Street in here, which is a very a dense residential area. So we want to be careful. We want to be able to tweak the regulations to account for the fact that you've got a lot of houses very close together. But you also have some areas in this part, like Washington Street, in this area over here, that could be purchased up and then built into a nice mixed-use center. Yeah, John.
Jeff, I'm curious on that point about that section along High Street there. I assume part of your dialogue was forward-looking planning versus
yes.
somebody else swooping in and determining what your fate's going to be. Do folks now understand that this is really the more deterministic of outcomes? You can kind of control your own destiny to a greater degree? And are you seeing that they don't react so negatively that they might have a couple years ago?
It was interesting because we actually had people say,
I wish I had.
Yeah, because
in favor of this.
The opposite was going on when that discussion was happening before.
Yeah.
People really need alternatives. If there's only one thing in the room and versus the status quo, they'll always pick status quo. But if it's the, say it very badly, the lesser of two evils or the better of two outcomes, you really have to portray it that way because we're getting feedback. Why didn't we do this earlier? Hey, folks, we tried to do this earlier, right?
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Well, I think it's important to note that whether or not we tried to do it, I mean, we had a, what happened, and this happened a number of years ago, is that there were public hearings similar to the ones that you had, and a few people said, literally a few people
not
said,
here.
We're not here.
Yeah.
And so rather than think about the greater good of the town, those voices kind of, you know, blew it right out of the water, and as a result, what we ended up with is a 40B that we've been wrangling with for a year. And so, I mean, there are some things to consider. I mean, the area there that's, you know, not red, but, I mean, if an overlay happens there, that doesn't evict you from your home.
No, absolutely.
I mean, it doesn't do anything like that. I mean, what it does is it actually may create an opportunity that you currently don't have with your home. But it changes nothing to the current homeowner. So I mean, I think we've got to be, in some cases, bold where we have never been bold in this town.
Sure. I think a couple of points to that. I think people are more open to it now that they've seen what a 40R district can look like. You look at the building that has pamplemousse in it, and they're, wow, this is actually really nice.
And, yeah, and people live upstairs, and
yeah.
You know.
And then I think at the last meeting that we were all at, and then at the public forum, did a really good job of explaining the fact that this doesn't mean, to your point, John, that we're going to come in and bulldoze your whole neighborhood. Like, this
right.
is just another option. It's another option for developers to use to possibly build something that is a little bit more unique, but very kind of adapts well with its surroundings.
In fact, if anything, we've added value to those.
Yeah, I was just going to say that exact
yeah.
thing. I mean,
yeah.
what you may do by creating an overlay there is create an opportunity that people there might otherwise never have.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's right. No, absolutely. Let's go to the next slide. And what you'll see is we're just kind of zooming in on this area right here, because
yep.
this ultimately becomes the area that we want to focus in on. So in the yellow, you've got the existing 40R, and then you kind of round it out here. Again, a lot of emphasis on this area. There was a lot of attention there. People felt like that area of Main Street, kind of pulling up the hill as you approach the green, was really ripe for this type of development. And in this area, absolutely, I think that they were very interested in that as well, but there were a lot of Green Street residents there that said, look, I think I get it, this makes sense, but I just want to make sure that there's the right protections in place and that we're not going to just, slap a 40R over it.
Right.
So
well, the idea of slapping something on it and then people, fear sets in that something's different, and are you going to, literally, are you going to bulldoze my house? It's, it really isn't that,
yeah.
At all. And I think it's really important as you, I'm thrilled that you're conducting these hearings, and, and I'm so glad to have you all visit us and tell us about it. I think it's really important to be just painfully precise and
yeah.
patient. The idea that you move it out, to annual town meeting instead of squeeze it into November probably gives you that opportunity to kind of do what we've been doing recently around the financial issues.
Yeah.
And
it can help. You can, I don't want to say tie the two together, but you can point at some of the work that's being done to help address.
It does tie
right.
it does tie
yeah,
them all
absolutely.
Together. It's kind of a master plan, if you
yeah,
will.
Yeah. John, did you have a question?
I did. So I was also a little surprised that deep red district didn't continue along the railroad tracks all the way up to the yellow on High Street.
Oh,
is that
area?
It? Yeah, because there are businesses there, but they're all single story, right?
Similar businesses to Main Street.
Right.
I think that's already in the 40 R's.
I don't think so.
Which side of the street?
Washington Street,
northerly side of.
Yeah, I think the what you don't see in yellow are those apartments, the
yeah.
couple of apartments there. I think
yeah.
there's.
Well,
there's
the right in here. We've got basically the multifamily.
Yeah.
Right.
The big parking lot in the center. And that's one of the things which is. It would be a large redevelopment, but it's probably one of the candidates, the prime candidates. This area with the small houses, tiny streets, and there's some topography is really challenging for any developer, for any change. If we can come up with a good alternative opportunities there, I'll be happier, but a little bit surprised. It's a tough nut.
But Dave, that very thing, could I just ask you a question? Because of that, and I think you're really right about that, that it makes it tougher if you think of it as a developer. But by being inclusive, I think you challenge a developer for a major project similar to what happened really on Haven Street. I mean, and so I just think it's something, I don't think you create harm by being inclusive. I think you create opportunity, and nature will take its course. If it doesn't make sense because of the topography, and it doesn't make sense because all of those people are very happy with their homes exactly the way they are and would prefer to, then fine. the free market and nature will take its course.
Well, the town and the residents there have said, you know, talk to me.
Yeah, that actually makes sense that they would say.
This is the one he's got and needs to.
The area here is more interesting because this is the Washington Street. This is probably the toughest intersection in the entire town.
Yep.
And there's a lot of variation here that may or may not present opportunity. You know, we've got to do some more investigation in that area.
Yeah.
So John, I think the question you had.
Yep.
Washington Street, the yellow ends at Washington Street. So I think it encompasses all those single story businesses that you're thinking of.
You're thinking extending along here?
I think it misses one, but I think that's an apartment house as well. The last building on High Street before it goes yellow to orange, I think that's an apartment right there. I think that's an apartment house there too.
Yep.
So I think you're right.
I think it does.
Okay.
I think it, the 40R is already present.
Yep.
In those single story buildings, single story businesses that, you know.
The lesson here for me is that there's a natural tendency to, for people to just do what's comfortable and what they've always done, and they really need to be presented with an alternative and what might happen but for that alternative. And kind of this is really instructive as to what's happened. I'm not sure there's a way to bottle that up, but as you go forward and promote this, there really has to be, you know, if you don't do this, we have more control, you have more authority as a landowner. You have more value add.
Right.
It can't just be you are here today and let's talk about what the future might be.
It really, I also think the idea of creating that kind of a smart growth district, to John's point, puts so much more control in the hands of the actual homeowner or property owner and the town's influence. If we haven't woken up in the last year to, you know, what can happen to us. I mean, past development has put us in a position where the numerator and denominator around affordable housing is very, it's more skewed than ever. And so as a result of that, the steps you guys are taking, I think, is critically important to the whole strategic future of Reading. I mean, whether it's from economic development to, how to manage operating budgets to how to encourage the right kind of growth. I mean, this is really, I think, a very important step you guys are in the middle of right now. We just need to really vet it so that, you know, we think about the greater good of how the town develops.
Oh, that's humbling. Thank you. And let's talk about next steps. Go to the next slide. I want to skip over the first three. Let's talk about downtown zoning, because obviously that's the topic that's nearest and dearest to us right now. So as of right now, actually, you know what? Let's go to the next slide. So as of right now, we've got a lot of feedback from town citizens on what their preferences are for the zoning and whatnot. We have obviously a presentation tonight. We've got another presentation on the 28th with the business community. And then we would definitely like to conduct, if you would be open to it, a joint CPDC Board of Selectmen meeting sometime this summer. And we would almost see it as coming back with the same audience. Obviously everyone else would be welcome to it, but kind of following up on all of that feedback that was collected and sit down with them and kind of review with them, this is what was provided to us. Now let's get a little bit more, let's get a little closer to this and understand what the opportunities are. I think a big element to it is kind of giving some visuals of what Main Street coming up into the town center would look like if some 40R projects were built, and kind of work with the citizens so they can get over any fears that they might have and get a little bit more visual into what the possibilities are. So that's what we would like to do. And then another reason why, not only do we want to push it out because we want to keep having that conversation, we also almost need to push it out because the DHCD timeline to review and approve our applications is extensive. I'm forgetting.
Also somewhat unknown.
It's a wild card.
Yeah.
2 months, 3 months. So we felt like if we tried to get it in for November, we could be at risk of having to pull it.
Yeah. Next week, you guys are, according to that meeting with the business community, is that the chamber, or is that just an ad hoc group?
Yeah, we did a mailing we have a database of over 200 businesses, so we did a mailing to that database. We did some internal cross checks with public health and some other divisions in public services. So we are collaborating with the chamber, and so the chamber's agreed to do an email blast. I don't know if it's gone out yet. I don't think it has. But
I think that they have already, you know, they're beating the drum about that.
Yeah.
Now, is that going to be in Reading Cooperative?
Reading Cooperative Bank, 5 to 6:30 today.
It's an early evening meet and greet, basically.
Right.
We had one, I forgot exactly what it was, a couple of years ago, that was very useful.
Yeah, I actually attended that one, and it was really very well done. I think that's a good idea.
We're aiming for the same kind of thing with a little bit more information up front.
And we didn't even ask for RSVPs because we want people to feel casual, and if they can go, great. If they can't, no problem. So we're not even keeping track of who's coming, who isn't coming.
It's so different from trying to organize a 7 o'clock nighttime government meeting.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think
it's not
that's
what it's
a
meant to be.
Wise choice.
Yeah, and I think it'll be well attended. I think these are probably the exact folks that you want to hear from in regards to these proposed overlay districts.
And
these are the folks that are going to be most helped, quite frankly.
Right.
If in the grand scheme of things, we can create an environment that actually the business community embraces and utilizes.
I would even suggest that you let the MAPC know and encourage them to invite people who might be considering Reading. I mean, it's something to think about. Go ahead, Jeff.
Let's go back to the previous slide.
Dan, did you have a question before we moved on?
I wondered if Bob could interject when our planner person is coming on board. How does that play into this?
I don't know. Sometime in the next month or two.
Okay.
Or a couple months, I should say.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Yeah, this one. So this is the status of
Jeff, back up for a second. You noticed the 7th, the 11th, and the 20th. Here we go. So is this the time that you intend to have us meet jointly as we've done before and as
no,
we are right now?
We don't really have a date set for that.
Okay.
I think when we talked about it, we were thinking sometime in August,
late
realizing that there's a number of
There will be a collision of things happening,
exactly.
As you're well
aware.
So we
need to be careful
or a joint
when
meeting
we
of several boards.
Yeah.
So this is all around public hearings. So site plan review and the minor amendments that we discussed earlier, all of those are in final draft form, and we have hearings scheduled for those on July 11th. The signed bylaw is in draft form, but it's very close. In fact, I think we've got just a few more tweaks that we made last night. We're going to meet again, talked about the 28th with the business community, and then we have a public hearing scheduled for July 25th on that. And then downtown zoning, as I mentioned, we've got a lot of good feedback. We're going to keep discussing it in our sessions. And if we can agree on a date and time to have a joint meeting, pick up where we left off after we collected all that feedback and help people get a little bit more visual and realize that it's an option, it's more flexibility, and it's really in their best interest, not just personally, but for the town, to look at these items.
Yeah, and I'll make sure I can attend as many of these as I can. Speaking as a realtor, you are going to increase their property value. You know, you're going to make it's a more desirable outcome, I think, for everybody as a result of that.
You know, that's an element, Kevin, that if you could distill that into a slide or two that could be included from the perspective of somebody in the business, that's got huge credibility. We can all say it, but somebody who does it knows it cold.
I can probably pull it up where it's happened in other communities.
I'm not talking about dollars and cents, but even if it's just directional.
I was talking about dollars and cents.
Yeah.
But yeah, even just in theory, yeah.
But the important thing is that becomes a homeowner option, not a homeowner requirement.
Yeah.
And I think, look.
Puts another tool in
the
belt.
Nobody wants to be told what to do. I, nobody gets that better than me. I mean, It's probably why I sit here now. So I think it is important that you talk about that in terms of a nice option, you know? I mean, but nobody's being, you know, forced into anything, so.
Well, it's unfortunately, we can't wave a magic wand and make the parking issue go away.
No.
But the, and it's not something that we have to be conscious of every step of the way.
The beauty of a 40R, though, an overlay, is now suddenly you can have some internal controls. It actually, it puts you back in position to make certain either variances or requirements. I mean, you know, you're in a stronger position to do that.
It brings the design guidelines into play, which is one of the key things we're looking for.
It also brings the outside market to you to try to tell you what to do instead of you needing to figure it out.
That's exactly.
That's
really got to be
the market forces are so important in this discussion that.
Gentlemen, that's really what we want to cover today. Are we taking any more questions?
Just one last one. It's really hard here because you're both trying to grow and expand and clarify. At the same time, you're trying to simplicate and remove what's not working. And you think you're striking the right balance where you're able to pull out what's not working, feel comfortable with pulling it out, and
so far, yes.
I think we have, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, honestly, I talk about the small changes that we're needing to make, the tweaks following use of the bylaw, that after the changes that we've made, it's not a lot of changes. And they're pretty straight.
Just be ready for the ride in November.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
And the only thing that I would recommend is just, I mean, there's no such thing as just doing a little tweak of the bylaw. That could be, you know, a little tweak could be two nights on one, you know, one section. So
remember bees and chickens.
Right. So my recommendation would be is to figure out a way, you know, to basically condense what's really kind of technical kind of language into sort of this is what we're trying to do,
mm-hmm.
right? And sort of, you know, I'm not saying lead people, but you know, get less of the wordsmithing and more of this is what it used to do and this is the intent and this language in front of you gets to the intent in a way to kind of, and that's the hardest thing is to simplify complicated when especially everybody has their own opinion and experiences. And that's the only way, because Bob, what did you say? It's going to be like 4 or 5 nights at town meeting?
I think we reserved it for 8 nights.
For 8 nights?
It could be a barn burner. I'm telling you, buckle up for November.
Yeah, and right,
there's
that's not the only thing that's
on
there, but just, you know, to figure out, you know, spend some time sort of figuring out a presentation that, you know, gets, you know, folks to kind of, you know, to simplify it. That's all I can kind of recommend, because otherwise it gets bogged down.
That's really good advice. You know, I mean, you can prepare. You guys are, I would just want to compliment you, because I think you've done in here what Barry's asking for. I think, you know, that it's good advice. Continue doing what you're doing the way you're doing it. It will have smoother sledding as you move through, you know, 130, 140 odd people who are going to all have various opinions about, you know, how you've how you've fragmented the sentences.
Some of it is presentation. I mean, some of it is avoiding the red flags.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's, you know, I've been through 10 years of town meetings plus now, so.
Yeah.
I've been on both sides of the issues on some occasions.
But, you know, wouldn't you agree, Dave, that it's not about not being, it's not about not putting a red flag out, it's about changing its color so that it's transparent and easier to understand. I think it's not about not putting all the information out there, because I've listened to you talk about, you know, clarify information often.
Well, the trick is to make sure that you don't accidentally leave something out.
Yes.
Mm. You have to be upfront and complete. And we've missed that on a couple of occasions, and it bites back.
Yeah, good preparation, I think, will avoid that. So will we hear back from you about your proposal to get together in late July or early August? Yeah, I would say that just thinking out loud, the earlier in August that we could do that, the better.
Okay.
Don't you think, Bob? Because I think as we move towards the end of the summer.
Our plate's gonna be.
Yeah, I mean, it's.
Well, I think you've also just had three public meetings where there was a whole new section of the town that's interested in this topic broadly, that wasn't interested even 2 years ago.
That's true.
I will tell you, there are people that did not come to your meeting who would have suddenly, they came to listening sessions for us to talk about operating budgets. And you'd be amazed how much discussion came up about economic development. I mean, it was just, it was a huge driver in all of the discussions, so.
And just in ending, I just wanted to thank the committee and the planning staff for all the work that you've put in the last, what, 2.5 years or so. You've had a lot of weight that you've been carrying, and it's greatly appreciated. It's a lot of work to get through all this, and don't think that goes without being noticed, so thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Any other questions? Thanks.
The opportunity.
Yep.
Thanks.
We'll see you again soon.
Okay, it must be 8:45 now.
Yeah, it must be 8:45.
So Brad is pacing in the.
Brad is pacing and peeking and.
Someone can tell Brad he's on.
Oh, yes, adjourned.
Yep.
Second. We gotta adjourn. All in favor?
Okay.
All right. Night.
Closed up at night. Thank you.
The other night we didn't adjourn officially, but we effectively adjourned.
No, we did.
We did.
We did.
Oh, we did?
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
We tried to get you, but
we voted.
It was a 2-0.
That's 2-0.
It doesn't matter. I walked out. It's over. Good evening.
Good evening. Sorry for the late.
Sorry we're delayed.
Whatever the opposite of the emergency preamble.
Some exciting talk about margaritas, though.
Margaritas and no parking zones.
We can't serve them for you tonight.
So, you guys are here to visit and talk about 172 Woburn Street.
Yes, we are.
Floor is yours.
Where's the best place to start, right here?
Actually,
that's not it.
It's Chipotle.
That's
Chipotle. Oh, sorry. I can't see.
Get margaritas out of the way.
You have a thumb
Chipotle
drive.
Chipotle is, they're down there serving margaritas right now.
Better not be.
Better not be.
Might be drinking them then.
I think it's 5H5 if you want to get to.
Oh, okay. Let me just try to find it here.
Drive down a bit more.
F.
There you go.
Ooh, I think I missed something on
next
the board.
Slide, right after that.
Right there?
Yeah. Or
yep. I actually think we've got some material that are.
You sent us some from last week.
Yeah.
Well, Mike Sullivan is here. I know we met with you before.
Yes.
Mike's the proponent. And Mike Jacobs, who's the affordable housing consultant.
Good evening. Good evening.
Yep.
Does a great deal of this, highly regarded by Mass Housing. And basically, when we appeared before you, previously we advised that we were looking to have 20 units placed on the property. And you said to us, please go and meet with the neighbors, which we've done. Right afterwards, Mike wrote to all the neighbors, gave his home phone number, or cell number, actually, and said, if you'd like to talk about it, here's what I'm trying to do, give me a call. Got people called me, got into a dialogue with them. After that, we then had a meeting. It was at at the Paris Center at the church, and invited all the neighbors who were abutting the property and across the street. We had about 35 people in attendance, very cordial, very understanding. They gave us a lot of good information about their concerns. And so the product we have now is a result of that input as well. So that was good advice. Basically, if I could go through an outline for you, at this point, right now, you see the traffic flows that take place here. The retaining wall is over in this area. It's very narrow coming if you're familiar with the site. And there's also a stairwell down here, so it's very restrictive. So in discussions that we had with the fire chief, they wanted that widened. So this plan actually moves that retaining wall in a westerly direction, to widen the entranceway and make it more usable and meet the fire department's standards.
You know how many feet you're moving it?
It's 18 feet. I think it's probably moving about maybe 6 or 8 feet in some areas. And the wall height varies. The highest point is about 6 or 7 feet. At that point, it's a structural wall, so they need a building permit, and there's attractive fencing that's going to go to the top of that wall out of concern of anyone falling off the wall. So that's what's being done in this area. We also heard that the neighbors down here on Wender had some problems, historical problems with water. And we know that there is an old large water line or drainage line that runs behind Parker, comes a wetland back that runs through here, crosses Prescott and unloads near Washington Park. So basically, there is a manhole here that services this one up in this area that has serviced this particular area, but apparently it's not adequate capacity. And so what can happen in a serious storm with the roof runoff and all this impervious area, it has to some extent sheeted over a little bit to these houses. Now, I understand from Father Rock that that's been solved, but the people are still very nervous about it. So that was an issue that they raised. So as a consequence of that, they're proposing certain things. First is, and I'm filling in for the project engineer who's on his honeymoon, who had the audacity to get married, so he's not here tonight, but having said that. So he designed this so that the runoff now is all being captured in a leaching area. So the recharge to the ground will not run off site in that regard. So that's one major change to help them. Secondly, these parking spaces are pervious pavement, so that allows a recharge in that area as well. And the third change is this is now near the catch basin is now a small rain garden to help absorb again the runoff as best we can. So while we're not, our project doesn't increase, in fact it decreases the impervious area, we are trying to address those issues to at least help if we can, or at least be neutral as far as the neighbors are concerned. In addition, of course, the neighbors were concerned about some screening. And so as a consequence, we put in this plan a fencing that would run along the site. We think that's attractive, and as we go through, if we get to ZBA, they'll probably give us input, but it seems to us that might be an attractive way to screen the neighbors, plus landscape.
And that's on top of the already 6 or 8 foot retaining wall on the west
side. On top of the retaining wall, and also down through here, perimeter as well. There is like chain link down there in some areas, and some areas have other kinds of fences.
So you're going to put the more of the stockade fence across the bottom and up
yes.
the other side of the neighbors?
That's correct.
Yep.
Just to try and give some screening for their benefit. The other item that we heard was, where's the dumpster going to be? And at one point it was down here. What we have done is we have actually recessed the dumpster into that wall. So what you have is, if you've been there, it goes up a probably 15 feet between the lower parking lot here and the church lot.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So they're going to cut into this bank right next to an existing stairway and actually have the dumpster be recessed with doors in front. So it's going to be totally encased or almost underground.
In its own cave.
Right. Mm. So that's what we thought was a good way to address that particular issue. other things, of course, that we discussed before that we tried to enhance is the appearance of the building. The building, of course, is an institution. It was constructed as an institution. One good feature, of course, is we do have a peaked roof, which is a nice feature. So that's going to obviously be preserved as a slate roof. But what's happening is all the windows are being changed from school-type windows to residential windows. And I'll go back to the presentation drawing, the colored one.
I have no idea. Back up one slide.
This
is it. This one.
Okay. Yeah, it's
so
kind of hard to
turn
see.
Your head sideways.
But we're putting a portico on the front.
View.
Again, to make it more residential.
View rotate.
There are no windows in the front now. There are no
take
windows
a chance.
In the front.
Oh, that was so lucky.
So they've been putting windows in again in the front. Extensive landscaping in the front area. We submitted, I think, with a package, maybe a supplemental submittal. Shows the actual nature of the species that would be there for planting. This one, and this is an ongoing process. This one shows a stairway here and a stairway on the other, or an exit on the other side. Of course, we have to have a handicap ramp on it as well. This is actually going to be eliminated because we don't need a stairway on both sides of that entranceway. And frankly, that lets us have more pervious area, get rid of one of the walkways on that side. So that's a further refinement, but that's substantially what is being proposed here.
And there'll be a ramp on the other side?
Yeah, the ramp comes down, it zigzags, ends down here, and then it's at grade to go right out there to that side.
And in that view, that front hallway wall is right on the sidewalk, I presume. That is the street we're looking at.
The street here.
That's the sidewalk in front of it.
Sidewalk here, and that's exit and entrance.
I remember one of the issues was snow, and that, you know, plowing the back.
Good point.
And I think it was going to be sort of kind of tucked in the corner there, but that's now where your rain garden is,
right.
And then also you'll lose some parking spaces as that melts
right.
and refreezes. So
right.
is there any effort to move snow off-site?
There is. In a storm of a certain intensity where we can't safely put it on the site, the applicant understands he's going to have to remove it. And that could be a condition, of course, of any comprehensive permit. But you're right, that was something that we did feel we had to address.
The only storage area on site is that rain garden. Is that true? That's the only only area you have.
Yes, that's correct. I think there's an elevator.
No.
The main entrance is, of course, for the occupants will be the back of the building. When they park and back, they can enter there and go right up the elevator. One of the units is going to be universally accessible for handicap. The unit mix is going to be 9 one-bedroom, 9 two-bedroom, and 2 three-bedroom. And the state law requires it to be 3 bedrooms. We don't
9 two, 9 one, and what?
And 2 three-bedrooms.
To minimize the impact on schools.
And what percentage affordable?
25%, so 5 units would be affordable. But because of the nature of the use being an apartment, 100% will count towards the town's affordable housing inventory. I think those are the major points, and Mike can answer any questions you may have on the affordable housing aspect, or Mike Sullivan can answer any particular questions you have on the project. But our hope is that you'll feel sufficiently comfortable so that we can go forward and looking for your endorsement, at least the feeling it's a worthwhile project. Mike has already met with the Mass Housing, and they plan to file with them probably, what, in a week or two? Very shortly.
Is the building today a three-story building as
yes.
it stands today? Is it?
Yeah, it's a lower level first.
Okay.
Yes, it is three stories. What happened was there was a gymnastic academy there,
mm-hmm.
and what they did is they actually removed one of the floors in this portion inside, so that's going to have to be rebuilt.
Okay.
Yeah, Dan.
Could you talk about the detail of the merged entrance? Now, you're reversing the flow around the building.
Right.
Correct. How are those going to come together, and what's
sure.
the nature of the detail there?
The feeling of the church, and the church influenced this, is that they have, of course, parishioners who are elderly, and they wanted to make sure that at first we talked about coming in this way for both this project
mm-hmm.
and for the church. The church's concern was there's a rise on their site, and they felt that some of their parishioners would not feel comfortable driving up that area. And as a consequence, the discussion was, well, as long as we have them consistent, let's consider it going out in this direction as an exit. In addition, the thing we heard, we reversed it, was people were concerned with the headlights. That in this case they'd come and they'd shine over in these houses, and these people had concern, as did the people on this side of the church with the reverse direction. So this way keeps the flow the same as it is now on the church and reverses the flow here. And the idea here will be obviously to have signage to make sure the confluence of that traffic is appropriate. And of course, we have a traffic engineer, by the way, who's going to be assisting us with the traffic counts for the Zoning Board of Appeals process. And I should mention parking is on the side.
There'll be a double curb cut now. There won't be a crossover like there is now. Into the single
right
curb
now
cut.
It shows it's one, maybe wider. As far as parking is concerned, the Reading Zoning bylaw requires 1.5 for each unit. I know the town's faced with some others going much fewer than that. This is actually going to exceed the Reading Zoning requirement. So instead, that would require 30 parking spaces. We're proposing 35 here. The church has a certain number that we've brought them on this plan to show them, but we know the church is not going to use those a great period of time. They'll need them on Sunday and certain religious holidays and so forth. but we believe that we can work out some arrangement with the church when they're not involved in that to maybe use those for certain guest parking. But that's got to be worked out with the church. But anyway, we tried to dedicate or show which spaces are going for what particular use.
They'll be assigned to the apartments. Will it be assigned parking? Is that the plan?
I'm sorry?
Will it be assigned? So in other words,
oh, yes,
I mean, do I get number 22 and,
yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
So.
And that we'll be blocking to show the church so that the, and Mike runs a tight ship, so he'll make sure that his occupants know you have to violate the church parking spaces.
Okay. And Mike, is it your current plan to maintain this as the landlord?
It is, yes.
I mean, I realize, you know, things change, but
yeah,
you know, that does sound like I thought originally.
100%.
Okay. Questions from the board?
Great project.
What would you describe the tenor of the meetings as you brought forth some of the improvements? I mean, I know this is all subjective and based on your memory, we all view meetings differently. But can you characterize what the consensus was, if there was one?
Well, first of all, they were very cordial, and they listened to us, and they made comments. And the only thing that I really heard was the issue of the drainage. And I had a nice conversation with the owner right down here. In fact, my wife happens to know her, and she was very nice, and just she wanted to see what we could do to help her. And I think that what Mike is doing is everything could possibly done to help her. I didn't hear anyone just saying, "Oh, we don't want that. That's crazy. Don't do that." It wasn't that kind of environment. I'm not sure if you've heard from anybody.
Not for a while. No.
Okay.
That's generally a good sign.
Mm. Well, I thought the meeting
was nobody.
just saying, you know. I mean, because at other times we'd hear a lot. So I think that's no news is good news. Actually, when are you scheduled? Scheduled with the ZBA soon.
What we have to do is Mike has to file, and we have to get a site approval letter. From Mass Housing,
right,
which will be done as soon as he's able to do that. We want to get the flavor of the board first, and then apply. It looks like this would be a friendly 40B process.
Yeah.
And then you'll apply. How long does it take?
So what would happen? Our goal was to try and apply by the end of the month. They would then send out a letter to the. We would apply. An application would come into the town, coterminous lead with Massachusetts Housing Partnership. They would send out a 30-day comment letter to the town. They would be ordering a land appraisal as well. That process typically takes about 2 months or so before they would issue a project eligibility letter. Then we would finish our traffic study, and so it'd probably be about 3 months before we would submit to the zoning board.
So Mike, do you have it under, have you taken ownership of it now?
No,
it's under contract, it's all pending.
Correct,
approvals,
yes.
And
now, isn't there Bob, maybe you can refresh me. Isn't there a way that you could apply with a certain title towards a 40B that's one different from there? Yes.
Well, I was going to ask just to clarify when you said friendly 40B, you're not asking for a LIP.
No, it's not a LIP proposal.
Okay. So friendly is just a word.
Yeah, friendly
not
is just
not
a word
legal
meaning.
I know that there was another term,
yeah,
you know,
right.
Yeah.
And you've chosen not to do that because.
We're applying to Massachusetts Housing Partnership for a couple of reasons. One, they work much better with small developers. Two, they have a particular financing program with a sort of longer term in amortization, which works better with small programs.
Right.
Three, the LIP has certain design standards in terms of the square footage, which, because this is an adaptive reuse of a building, those square footages don't quite work with the LIP. So that's
so
why.
You know, you have to be working from scratch a little bit more than you are now because you're working with the building.
Yeah, so that's why the LIP just didn't quite work for us.
Mike, what's the square footage of the units, roughly? I don't know if you have it scoped out yet.
The one bedrooms are like 750. No, six. A lot of them are 690, which is a problem. The LIP standard is 700, so we're just a little below that.
Mm-hmm. The two bedrooms are 950.
Two bedrooms are in the 950 range, and then the three bedrooms are
1,200.
1,200, yeah.
The heating of the property is natural gas or oil?
Right now it's oil, but we're considering natural gas or electric right now, not oil.
So if you did leave it as oil, you'd need to manage deliveries as well in a USD ISO, yeah?
Correct.
It, will definitely not be oil. It's just it'll be an Energy Star system. It'll either be a gas or a high efficiency electric system.
So you're here to show us, which I appreciate. I mean, it's really good to see, you know, what you're doing. I think you personally think your process has been a good one. I mean, we ask you to go visit the neighbors. You've done that. What is it that you're really looking for from us? Is this a friendly visit to, you know, encourage the...
At least the consensus that hopefully that the select committee, that the proposed plan is workable and would be welcomed in the town.
Yeah.
As a reuse of existing building.
Yeah. And so, but I mean, of course you realize, I mean, you're going to have a hearing with the ZBA. That's not us.
Right.
I mean, you know, you're following your process with Mass Housing, and that certainly all makes sense. I personally like the use of this, but that's just me personally looking at it, thinking that suddenly we have a building that's not being used at all, that suddenly, you know, people are living in, and its application to our affordable housing challenge is very helpful, in my opinion. I don't know how everybody else feels about it, but... And I don't know that this requires some kind of a voter resolution, but generally speaking, that's my personal opinion.
I appreciate that. The context would be that when the site, when the Mass Housing Partnership corresponds with the town has an opportunity to comment. And knowing that the Board of Selectmen are opposed to the project is important to us.
Yep.
Mike, you asked the question about its contract relationship with the Archdiocese, and it gets expensive to go through the process, not just for the plans and so forth you see, but also in contract extensions. And so we're trying to feel that we're not going to get to a position of selectmen say we don't like what you're doing somewhere down the road. So that's what we're trying to communicate.
Yep.
And have it be in the context of friendly and so forth.
Yes, John.
I mean, the most important opinions aren't in the room. I really would like to hear from the neighbors myself to make sure all is well. This looks like you've listen carefully and taken a number of positive steps. It looks attractive. It looks like you've dealt with traffic problems. But at the end of the day, it's what we're kind of the minimum fish and game. I really want to hear what the neighborhood says through the ZBA process. I'm supportive of this in its current form, but again, we'd want to hear that.
Yeah.
Bob?
Yes, Bob.
Yeah, as we've done for the last two 40Bs that have come through town, one is still active. You know, there'll be a formal application. We have 30 days to comment. I'll want to know the input of staff, the fire chief, the police chief, the planning department, Board of Health.
Yeah.
So that'll play a key role. Nothing to say that your opinions don't matter either.
No.
There's a lot of people.
But they kind of don't matter,
kinda
really.
Don't.
I mean, other than personally speaking.
right.
I mean, it sounds
but,
like
you know, I'll reflect the comment of everyone.
Yeah.
Anyone that wants to make an individual comment, please send it to me.
I know when we did the first cut, you know, we sent you back and directed you to talk
yeah.
to the neighbors and come
yeah.
back with, you know, improvements based on those conversations. On its face, it looks like you've done that. And,
yeah,
and
it looks like
so
you've done that with the fire chief as well.
And so that's,
yeah,
I mean,
and
that's
I assume
great.
That'll come through in all the comments.
Right.
So.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, my general take on it is, you know, it's a building that was going to be reused. You know, so now you're taking it and you're improving the site
right.
To... You know, the fencing actually is a very nice stockade fencing. You know, trees that are going to be up and around that for even further screening, but it looks like on the plans, is that correct? You know, so from the neighbor's standpoint, that would be a drastic improvement over the current site that is right now. So, you know, I'd agree with Bob. You know, at this point, I'd say this is, you know, this is great. I think you guys have acted as a quote-unquote friendly, 40P project moving forward. Listening to, as John Arena mentioned, listening to, hearing from the abutters, and definitely hearing from the department heads would be a big role in continuing that, making sure that it is going to be a good project.
Yes, Dan.
I agree with everything that's been said. I also understand that the parking split between the church and this building has been worked out over many months with the ZBA. In fact, this started when the building was originally planned for reuse for the school. So there's been a lot of water over the dam on that subject, and I think an equitable plan is they come up with it. So it's a great project.
Yeah, and it really, I mean, I'm glad you came to visit us.
Yeah.
I'm glad to hear about this project. Honestly, our opinion will be heard, but the important ones are not ours.
Right.
And I think John Arena makes the great point that it sounds like you've taken the steps with the abutters, because those are the ones that, you know, are the most important, because therein will lie your support, you know, or your detractors. And, you know, Mike, what you're doing, what, I mean, over the years, I've owned rental property many times, and being friends with all the neighbors of the rental property was the most important thing I ever did. And it sounds like you're already taking those steps. So it seems to me like you're on the right path here. I'm hearing a general consensus from everybody up here that we're kind of excited about, you know, the progress. Sounds like you're doing the things that we would hope you would do to make it that friendly thing, that you know, that adjective that everybody seems to like to put in the front
of
it.
Well, we appreciate your time and your comments, and if there's anything you want us to do by way of communicating with the neighbors, let us know.
Thank you.
They say there were 35 in attendance, more or less.
That's good. That's great.
It went well.
I just stay in touch with them all the time. I would just let that be a nonstop kind of, you know, here's where we are, this is what we're doing. People love information.
Have you distributed this plan to the abutters? This now finished?
They had an earlier version, and I'll tell you what the difference was. The difference was that the wall hadn't, this wall hadn't been moved.
Yep.
That was a fire chief comment afterwards. The dumpster was over here on the plan they saw. Other than that, it was substantially the same plan as far as the site goes.
To John's point, I mean, I'm sure these full-size, D-size schematics are cheap, but if you printed up 35 of those on a printer and distributed them to the neighborhood and just did over-communicate, it goes a long way to dealing with.
I'd be having a cookout in the parking lot this summer.
Yeah.
That's just me, though.
Bring in a jumpy house. You know.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Right,
thank you.
Thanks for coming
thank
out.
You.
Appreciate it.
Next.
We have a debt sale that we've
Yeah, you have a very
about.
Long motion, unfortunately.
Yeah, I saw that.
But there will be no signatures tonight. I'll need to ask
thank
you to
God.
Come in separately to do that.
Right.
We still have to produce the paperwork. It'll probably be next week.
Bob, can you explain the concept of the total interest cost? There's two or more components that roll into the total cost of debt. Is there a premium, return of premium?
Yeah, I was going to say it's a little misleading. On page 4 of tonight's packet, I promise not to spend a lot of time on this. You see the 2016 maturity, $705,000, 3% interest rate.
Yes.
There's a very high premium on that, so someone, and I don't remember what it is, someone is paying $107 to get $100 back next November and enjoy a 3% interest rate. The yield on that is 0.4%. So the long and short of it is there's lots of different buyers in the marketplace with lots of different motivations. Some people buy coupon, and they're willing to lose principal in order to get coupon. It doesn't matter why, that's just what they do.
They want the surety.
So they're getting a 3% interest rate, and they're losing, you know, 7%.
Giving up principal to do it.
Yeah, over a short period of time. So, you know, one of the things I noted was 100,000 of that 705,000 is the Birch Metal Lighting Project. The interest cost for that, I think, was $1,025.
Yeah.
So that's the time value of money for 6 months or whatever it is. So the interest rates here, you know, the interest rates are what they are, but the net interest cost or the total interest cost, you can look at it two ways that are very similar, is 0.4% on the shorter maturity and about 1.5 on that longest one, 1.6. And you don't see that anywhere in your documents. And the average, you know, the weighted average is the 1.26 that the chairman mentioned.
So basically we're selling bonds at different maturities. We're not
yes,
selling.
You're selling the longest ones. I think the 2026 and 7 are just water. And those had a cost of, in the ballpark, of 1.65% interest. True interest cost, including the premium.
Right. But when you're selling a bond, most people are getting their money back.
They'll get par back. But in this case, because they're interest, they're coupon buyers, they're paying more than par for it. Some of them are paying $9 and $10. So, you know, they're going to get $100 back. They're paying us $110.
Right. But they're getting the interest along the
way. And they're getting a higher amount of interest because they know they're going to lose principal.
Right. And they're doing that because they, they're buying it for income.
Well, and their municipal bonds on top of that, so they've got.
So they're double tax free.
You know, they're selling income, and they don't care about principal value. A lot of people that live on municipal or on tax exempt income truly don't care about principal as long as they get par back.
Right.
Right.
They're just living
on the
income.
And they hold it to maturity.
Right.
Well, yeah, because all they're doing is spend, they're clipping coupons and they're living off that, so.
Takes a while to wrap your head around that.
Yeah, well, from being in the bond markets, I quickly realized there's lots of different motivations, as opposed to people that just don't know what they're doing, they just have different motivations.
And it's still.
Especially when they start paying negative interest rates, I was kind of hoping for that, but that didn't happen. But there's a lot of that around the world right now.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Especially in Europe.
And there's still, there's no, people.
Put the money in your mattress.
You put it in the bank, or in the mattress, you get zero. If you put it
better in the bank.
If it's still there.
If you put it in the stock market, you risk losing your principal. Whereas here, you're getting income, so it's tax free.
$1.16 to get a dollar back, that's amazing.
It's the double barreled implication of the taxes, that's what's going on.
Yeah.
You get
tax free interest.
You get tax free interest.
Yeah.
And so, for the right buyer, it's. You know, it's kind of a no-brainer,
That's the missing ingredient.
That's the link that you have to understand.
So if you're in Massachusetts and you buy this debt, you're getting tax-exempt federal and state.
You can't write off the premium loss as a loss. There's an amortization schedule. If it dips below and you sell it, you can. That's not a loss you can realize to get that tax.
But the income tax implications are 38% tax.
These are fairly sophisticated buyers doing this.
Well, I'll agree with that until the things settle.
Well, or some fairly sophisticated sellers.
They're very sophisticated sales force that were given these to sell.
Yes.
John knows how that works.
Yeah, the repackagers are the where the sophistication lies.
But these aren't like pension funds buying this debt.
This is
like.
Absolutely not.
First Tennessee was the winning buyer, and I know what that sounds like, but they're a very reputable firm from my world in Boston. They will sell these all to retail. In Massachusetts.
Right.
Yep.
Quite possibly in Reading.
Right.
Almost unquestionably.
Yeah. And bear in mind, this is what they paid us. This is not what you'll get when you buy them.
That is correct.
They have a markup.
Right. Right. So they're putting these bonds in their portfolio, essentially,
right.
And then they're selling them.
Yep. And many of them would have taken orders in advance. So for a deal of size, they have to. Usually, a big deal will all be pre-sold, so they don't want to take any risk.
We have a pretty serious motion going on here, don't we?
Well,
do we suspend the reading at some point?
I would think at some point you could.
I would.
All right, so I'm just going to read the motion and someone make a motion to suspend it. Move that in order to reduce interest costs, the treasurer is authorized to issue refunding bonds at one time or from time to time pursuant to Chapter 44, Section 21A of the General Laws or pursuant to any other enabling authority to refund all or a portion of the town's $9,535,000 general obligation municipal purpose loan of 2007 bonds dated November 1, 2007, maturing on or after November 1st, 2018.
Mr. Emsinger moves that we
suspend
the reading.
Second.
Okay. And we do the discussion is in the interest of the fact that this is very readable. And it's very straightforward, and I think we've had some general discussion about this, and you know I'm comfortable suspending the rather extended reading in favor of.
Furthermore,
any other discussion? All those in favor? Okay. Now, do we have a second to the motion?
Oh, well, you just voted on suspending.
Yeah,
right.
Suspending.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Now, do we have a second to the motion? Okay, any discussion? All those in favor? And on we go to approve the debt sale. Done. Okay, now we've got 17 goals update and a draft on the 18 goals.
Yeah, I'll only do the first part since I don't have the second part.
Okay.
This is the 16 goals. I don't know what I put in your outline. I updated the board, I think it was in March, so I've highlighted things that have changed, and you know, maybe half or actually less, a third of them have changed. One of the things that I've learned in the last couple weeks is the state is formally undertaking a review of human elder services in the Commonwealth, a big one. It's going to take 2 years. So there's some discussion. Jean visited the Council on Aging a couple of weeks ago, and I don't know, I don't think she knew that then, I'm not sure. She discussed with the council whether they had funds available to help out with a local survey of some sort of, what's a master plan for human and elder services. And I don't know, she met with lukewarm interest, I guess I'll say. And since then, we learned that the state is going to do it for free, but it's going to take a long time. So it's not going to have any answer in the next year or two. So there's some discussion now at the staff level of which is better. And I will tell you that the state one is not going to give us all the things we want, but it is going to give us peer community data that's comparable. So that's pretty valuable. It'd be awfully nice to have the results of it now. Here's all the services Reading offers. Here's what the peers offer. See the difference. That's one of the things we know anecdotally, but we can't quantify. The state will do that.
Do you know if it'll be thorough enough to give you relevant data?
I would say I don't know, and generally I'd be a little low on the trust element for the state, but this is an area that's so important, I'd kind of hope they dig in and we could talk to our legislators. I don't even know what agency. I don't think it's MAPC that's going to do it. So I just throw that out there as, you know, we may, after more discussion and more understanding, abandon this as a local goal and just say, why do it if it's, cause it's going to take us 6 months to get an answer. But on the other hand, you know, there's nothing better than local flavor and local input, so.
My opinion is that we're going to spend 2 years getting that. If you get it from the state in 2 years, it'll be a miracle.
Probably, yeah.
I mean, they're forecasting a $350 million shortfall in their own budget. I mean, is this something that's going to...
Well, the beauty is the legislators are all heading for the human elder services needs category, so maybe they'll see that.
Well, there is that. I know the feeling.
I don't know. You know, it's going to be another choice, and you know, we'll have to make the choice at some point in the next, say, 3 months. We don't want to go out and do something someone else is going to do for us, if it's real and if it's timely. We'll find out more. I want to ask DPW especially to come in, although I know your agenda is going to be busy for a while, to give you a demonstration on the C-Click Fix and how it's been applicable. I can tell you I've used it secretly, I thought. It's really good. I put in a comment under my last name at 6 o'clock one night, and I used her father's address for a branch down. At 8:30 the next morning, DPW was out there fixing it. And later in the day, they sent an electronic answer, and they didn't know it was me. Although when they got there, they might have figured it out. But they didn't know when they sent the crew out there. I was really impressed.
I think it had a couple of glitches early, but
it did.
You know, like the follow-up was...
Exactly.
You know.
Yeah, there wasn't a lot of good follow-through.
Right.
And, you know, as is typical in these, you know, DPW is fixing problems, not doing computer work. But if they didn't close the issue, it looked like they weren't doing
right.
any work.
Right.
They eventually kind of said, okay, this is kind of not our job, typically, but if you're going to penalize that, we'll do it.
I got a message... That there was some that a neighbor had.
Did you get one also? Because I got one of those.
That's basically,
you've used the system.
I've
before,
used
though.
It, but like
that's
because
why.
There was something near me, they said
okay.
a neighbor
you
of yours on, and I forget
yeah.
it. Just said
I
has made
that.
A. Yeah,
I
thought
that
that's great,
to,
but
Jane
I didn't.
Kinsella about a week or two ago. I said, has anyone talked about this? We just got this, and I'm not sure we want it. How do we opt out? She said, I've never heard of this. You're the first one to come to me, so now you're the second.
Yeah.
I'll be the third.
Okay.
You got one too.
So she was going to ask them, is there a local way to opt out of this? As a town, can we just turn that off, or can we have the individuals turn it off? Because, you know, just because you reported a pothole doesn't mean you're going to care about a pothole five houses down from you. So, you know, that's interesting that you
yeah.
say that. I'll follow up.
This isn't reverse 911. This is C-Click Fix.
Right.
Yeah.
Bob, that metric of closing and cycling and time to complete and number of, that's all part of the goal number 6 as well,
yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, this, you know, as is often the case, there's pretty good data measures and reporting tools, but the data itself is not always great. So we have, you know, the permit system that the building inspectors use, and we can anecdotally tell you what the turnaround time. But there are some permits that have been in there for years and have never been closed out. And so from a data standpoint, it looks like, wow, your average response time is
well, you throw the outliers out.
But you can't. That's the trouble with these software programs is they make them tamper-proof.
Yeah, right.
Which I understand, they don't want you monkeying around with the answers, but you can't throw out bad data. So it's kind of a real challenge. Let's see. Board and committee communication, I would indicate that's half done, because at the staff level, we have finished all our work. And by that I mean making part-time jobs full-time and making John Feudo in charge of a lot of different boards that never used to talk to each other, and now they do. The general level of awareness among all our human elder services board is much better now. Health knows what's going on in council on aging and so forth, and as John Halsey will recall, the Board of Health hired a consultant to do a study, and some of the recommendations they made we already had, they just didn't know that.
Right.
So that was kind of an eye-opener. So at the staff level, we've done all we need to do. The question now for you is there some kind of, you know, coming together of a variety of boards that we need to do, and that's something we should talk about.
Mm.
I would not say it's going to be as helpful to have all the boards in. You've got to have reasons why you have groups of boards.
Right.
So you should think about that.
And whether or not
CPAC has had good meetings with you.
Yes.
The Board of Assessors will come in again. You've had some good meetings, but, you know, I'm telling you, if you could do that much more often, you'd get such a bang for the buck.
Right.
And neither board would feel like they're left out in some way. I do know some of your appointed boards, historically, especially 5 years ago, felt no part of the Board of Selectmen's thought process. Once they were appointed, you know, liaisons wouldn't show up. There was not a lot of feedback coming back from staff. It was just the annual appointment process. I think that feeling has changed now, at least among some folks, such as CPDs.
Is there anybody we haven't heard from in the last year?
No. I've made sure to bring them in.
Oh.
There's two parts of that.
Actually, let me think about that. There might be trust fund commissioners haven't seen you.
CBA?
No, but they're coming.
Well, you're going to ZBA, so I figured that was good enough. But
and actually, I'm going to their meeting.
I think they're coming in July.
Yeah, and I'm going to their meeting tomorrow for the first time to kind of get the lay of the land.
Goal
yeah.
line, does that also have to do with streamlining and permitting so that the boards, you know, CONSCOM and CPDC
I hadn't thought of that,
act
but
in
could
concert
be.
On applications?
Well, you know, that's part of the discussion in the VASC tonight was kind of streamlining the applicant's experience.
Yeah.
Okay. I was really happy to hear conservation has made what I would consider a significant improvement in their thinking in terms of not almost mandatorily having someone come in for two meetings minimum.
For instance, having an order of conditions pre-drafted.
So the staff will be able to write up a decision in advance. And
that is exceptionally good news.
Yeah,
hmm.
That's been a while. That's how planning has worked for many, many years.
Yeah.
And obviously there's times when you make your best effort as staff and that's not what gets discussed that night and agreed to, and you go back and you fix it and you have someone back.
Well, and it isn't about giving the store away either.
Right.
It's about trying to facilitate
right.
progress.
Yeah, it must have been very frustrating for an applicant to have been through one or two meetings, to be fully on board in agreement, and to hear, you know, we love what you're doing, it's exactly right, come back again and we'll hand you the final decision
happened
that we've just agreed to.
Happens so often.
Yeah.
And, you know, to say that time is money is an understatement in that situation.
Yeah, absolutely.
In some cases, it costs thousands as a result of that. And so I'm glad that that's a step forward. You know, on this, we have talked about the idea of maybe not bringing whole committees or not bringing multiple committees, but possibly bringing chairs and vice chairs together in a workshop setting. I mean, is there any appetite for that? I personally think that would be valuable.
I think that's the way to go because you're going to get quorum issues.
You're also going to get cross-pollination.
I think you should actually invite them into your CPDC meeting this summer. Because that's what you just heard from the community from the last 6 weeks, is look, you guys got to do better at this.
Hmm.
And not every board deals with that, but many of them do, peripherally. You know, the Council on Aging needs to understand there's efforts being made for economic development.
Because
it's going to have some implication on some of their population.
I think that there's very few that aren't touched by it.
I agree.
You know, even like Board of Health that connects to this.
Sure.
Because they're involved in businesses and so forth. That
you know,
may be a good idea.
And if you're discussing it sort of at the conceptual level, that's when you want to hear their feedback and they stop you from going down the wrong path on something.
Yeah.
So that's a possibility.
How do the rest of you feel about that? As a maybe a first step towards starting to assemble a cabinet of chairs and vice chairs?
I think it makes the most sense.
Yeah. I just think our bandwidth is so limited at this point.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe
well,
it's
best efforts.
Maybe it's something in the winter.
Well, if we pick, all I'm saying is this idea that Bob brought up, you piggyback them in and not with its own agenda, but
right.
invite them because it's
right.
pertinent and it's a message they can bring back, and then maybe that's a first step towards something in the winter. I agree with you, Barry. I think that
yeah.
we're not going to get anything done till the late fall at the earliest
yeah,
or the early
earliest.
Winter. So. Okay, sorry to derail you.
No, not at all. We've decided to keep our current 911 system for another year. We are looking at other vendors, but there wasn't any compelling reason to change. Let's see, economic development. I should have asked, I didn't ask Gene or Julie lately. The hazard mitigation plan, we've hired MAPC. I think they're almost done. That's required to be done by June 30th, so we'll eventually pretend we had done it. One issue that's one of the few that's zero, and that's by consensus of staff at least, was, you know, maybe it's a bandwidth issue, but we don't have time for an ad hoc master planning committee right now. And in fact, we've done virtually all the pieces other than the piece that sits on top that joins all the different plans that exist.
Once we get all the zoning done, the zoning done,
yeah.
Yeah.
then we can have the ad hoc.
Yeah. We're not ready for that.
And by that time, hopefully we have a planner.
Some people would have started with that. We didn't happen to, who knows why. That would have slowed you down 2 or 3 years anyways.
I think in general
think
this board has the end in mind already.
Yeah.
I mean,
agree.
I think we know where we're pointed. We don't need that first step in order to get, we need to
well,
be marching towards
it. I mean,
yeah.
Yeah. Sort of done
you've
it.
Done it indirectly or informally.
You
have reaching out on those economic development meetings when so many people came like over at the light department. That's effectively a master planning type meeting.
Right.
Yep.
Let's see. Parking in the downtown, you know, that came up tonight. That's, you know, in CPDC's lap and in PTTF's lap. You know, we still have very mixed feelings on that at a staff level. You know, statistically, we have enough parking. It's not where people want it.
Practically
speaking,
that's not true.
Walking. Gene has got a meeting set up with the MBTA next week. I may or may not join her. Others may or may not join her. They are quite aware that we've got a parking lot off them for free, and they're maybe not so interested in that anymore. But she's brought some other ideas to them that we had discussed that they hadn't thought about. That's just lots of their land is vacant and they just never used. So if you think of the land that leads into the Dennis properties,
yeah.
that's all their parking.
That's true.
No one's going to park there to walk to the train station. Mm-hmm. Maybe they could... You know, maybe Dennis would want it for a small bit of money. Maybe we'll come back to you with recommendations of employee parking from downtown. Why not just put them there?
Parking,
let them walk.
And were there walkways proposed there to tie the economic
yeah,
areas
right.
together? Yeah.
So, you know, the MBTA is somewhat of a struggling partner to be brought in, but maybe now that they're
right.
in financial difficulty, they'll be paying a little more attention. I don't know. We'll see.
You're talking about where you drive past Rite Aid?
Yes, on the right-hand side. There's some kind of a
there?
Pickup truck or boxcar truck that's been parked there for years.
Yep. You know, if you had some kind of a parking arrangement with a shuttle
right,
for
shuttle.
Employees, which would be a very inexpensive thing to do in a row, in the big picture of things.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, if that light department parcel ever gets developed, then there could be you can have a shuttle that just keeps going back and forth.
Yeah, just runs around.
And
yeah.
just takes people there to, you know, especially if there are businesses in there.
I have to
shuttle
tell you,
it down there. They take you to the restaurants and they shuttle you back. And
so every summer I end up in Cooperstown, and you know, in the summer you can't. I mean, there's nowhere to park.
Yeah.
Now, so they've got a whole shuttling system for tourists, but they have a separate one in a separate place. For all the people at work, you know,
oh.
you know, in the Cooperstown area, and I think that there is, start to talk about those parcels.
Yeah.
You know, free markets will drive solutions to this.
If you let it.
If you let it,
yeah.
I mean, it will drive solutions to this parking. I'm convinced of that. It doesn't mean we don't participate, but as some of those say, we do our role.
Yeah.
You know, you tee it up, and then nature starts to take its course after that.
And a lot of those businesses will pay for to subsidize those shuttles, they'll take people back to the train station.
Of course.
They'll do all that.
Yeah, there's lots of models out there. The board really gets a lot of its policy decisions. You know, does the board want the police department to be really cracking down on all the merchant parking, on the employee parking? Because they could do a better job of that if they had more staffing hours. It's just a matter of money. And then you're gonna have businesses in here every meeting complaining that they can't retain employees and they can't park. So there's lots of issues. There's lots of sides to the equation.
Yeah.
But, you know, we've talked a lot of crazy ideas at the staff level. There's some person on staff that wants to evacuate the train station parking and have it be for businesses only and move all the commuters off-site. So I said, well, I think that's a bit radical.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll just make the
that is fairly radical.
The $25 space will be far away and the $500
now
space
you,
might be
now
up front,
talking.
But you know, maybe we do that. We'll see. Recreation, you know, the lighting project is obviously on hold now. The library project, I had a meeting today around 4 with the owner of the construction company. It is going very slowly. We'll eventually, you know, drag all ourselves just over the finish line as best we can, but you know, we don't want to be here in 10 years talking about litigation. So we're all keenly aware of that. We have an excellent project manager.
Mm-hmm.
We've had generally good partners that have had some unforeseen issues having nothing to do with the town in terms of their own staffing. And they've said, you know, today a comment was made, I wish I had done this 12 weeks ago, not 6 weeks ago.
Yeah.
As from the owner of a company, he said, now I see something I didn't see before. And, you know, so we appreciate the honesty. And that's, we're being a pretty good partner to work with. We could be screaming and having a lawyer in there, and we're not doing any of that yet. But it's not been an easy project at all. And
there's hardly anybody working there.
On average, there's about 35 to 40 now. They're all inside, so
yeah, well, that's
you just
good.
Wouldn't see them. But yeah, they're supposed to be billing at $1 million to $1.2 million a month as of February. The highest one we've seen is about $700,000. So they're just not staffing the project.
That's because they got other stuff going on?
Yeah. But it's complicated because there's a lot of subcontractors. You can't always just, you know, they're supplementing their own workforce for some of the subcontractors. It's complicated. It's not a business.
Is there a guest? I mean, is it still?
We're still shooting
for
opening
fall?
In September.
Really?
So, you know, it's painful, but.
That's literally right around the corner.
Oh, yeah.
That's a good visibility thing prior to the October date.
Yeah, well. Good or bad, I don't know.
No,
well, I mean, it'd be good to get it done.
There's, you know, the library has tentatively picked a date, I don't remember, it's in October, to have a grand opening.
Mm.
And, you know, they're going to have it no matter what shape the building's in. As you know, the building is about $1.5 million away from being completed.
Right.
So that's
two months'
work, maybe three.
But the technology hasn't been delivered yet, the furniture?
It's all,
right.
You know, strategically lined up. It's like, you know, we're better than the Japanese at just in time. They've got spreadsheets like crazy.
Mm.
You know, delivery this day.
Yeah.
Lots of Bob has built in a tremendous amount of flexibility with all his vendors when he can. They're storing stuff for free. They're willing to work with him because he's being good to them. So you got to be infinitely flexible. And the only thing I regret is that early on in the project, you know, some of the folks involved in the building committee just ran us aground on some issues that just weren't that important, and wasted a couple months here and there. You know, I guarantee you if the permanent building committee were running this project, that would not have happened.
It would be a totally different project.
Yeah.
I mean,
maybe a totally different building.
Probably.
A totally different site.
I did have a chat.
Speaking of Oakland Road.
Yeah, I did have a chat with Town Council on Oakland Road, and I don't even understand what he said other than it's possible that prior council and prior engineering work might have to be fully revisited.
Oh, my God.
So he says, what kind of appetite do you have to spend time and money on this? I said, give me an idea of what you really think it's going to cost, or time-wise, to fix this, and when can we do it? So I had been aiming for a November town meeting, as he had been, and they have not billed us a lot yet, although their bills are running a month and a half late. He has uncovered some issues with the paper streets that he doesn't think the town is adequately taken care of. And remember, this is former town council that guided us, and former town engineer.
We have recourse there? I think we need to examine that.
You know, we've had the discussion with other projects in town, so it's not an easy one.
Well, the 75% is just getting the title, is what you're talking about. now we've got an RFP after that, et cetera, et cetera.
At some point on.
So do we even own the land then, is that what, is that?
Hold on, hold on, so how does that get to be 75%? Because we have all those other steps.
That, the 75% was before the conversation yesterday. And that's what went out to you last week.
It's like Candyland, we had fishing ladders.
That doesn't include RFP, decide what we want there.
No, the 75%, I thought the legal work was effectively done, I was getting this information through the engineers. And they had one thing left to do, and town council had two things left to do, and I said, all right, that's pretty good, then we just gotta decide what to do with it.
We can't use something like eminent domain to clear all that up?
I, you know, at some point I might invite one or more of you to have a chat with Ray and me. Because I don't wanna pretend to understand all his issues.
I'd really like to be, I mean, we need to talk about this.
Yeah.
Because we.
And he's not
going into the fall, we're gonna hear about this.
He's not saying you have a problem, he's saying, I've uncovered enough that I'm not comfortable yet, I gotta do a lot more to be comfortable. I said, okay, that's the question.
That's one of the two biggest parcels left.
Right.
And we're gonna wanna position that.
My own answer personally would be, not so much in June, because we have other budget issues. Do it. Whatever it costs, do it.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Because at some point, we're gonna either use this land or get rid of this land.
Absolutely.
We gotta understand what it is. And I thought we had passed that hurdle 3 years ago.
Yeah.
That's simple, we need clean title.
All the action at town meeting, we went back to town meeting twice.
I think Peter was here when we started this discussion.
Oh, yeah, oh, easily.
Yeah.
Yeah, we need clean title of that land.
You know, the school committee met and they, you know, had an article to give it to the selectmen or whatever, and, you know, we really thought it was all lined up. And maybe Ray will find out after more research it is, but from other projects he's worked on, my guess is something does not exactly.
I will tell you how far back this goes, I mean.
5, 6 years?
Oh. I will tell you this, while I was busy with the foundation over at Birch Meadow for the baseball field, engaged Peter in a discussion about turfing it with the proceeds of the sale of Oakland Road, 10 years ago. I mean, so this has been going on forever.
Yeah.
Well, Bill Brown will be telling you it's gone on since 1931.
Well, he tells you for sure the lights were due, you know, back in 1935, right after they lit Comiskey Park, so.
That's just a shame.
Let's finish stronger, guys.
For selectmen's policies, Matt, Gene, and I have looked at most of your policies. And I've actually asked Paula to look at all your licensing policies, since she's the one that generally is working with the public. And she's gonna come back, the first thing we're gonna bring back to you, probably in August, maybe September, vetted through town council, is a full set of licensing policies, including liquor. Rather than just doing liquor, you heard from Ray, you need to do that.
Yeah.
Do the whole thing. Make sure the whole set, that's probably the most important policy you have, I think. Because it affects people's livelihood. The rest, you know, sometimes you use them, sometimes we don't even remember there's a policy. I'll have some discussions with you individually.
Well, the fact that they've been untouched for so long says we should
yeah.
dust them off.
I told you I'd like to delete them all, but you were a little nervous about that. So we'll take a more measured approach.
You mean make it up as we go along?
Well, I didn't say make it up.
Oh, boy.
That's just exactly what you said.
I knew this thing was running off the rails from early tonight.
All right.
As you get gassed up, it gets easier. Goal 26 I thought was done, but we'll see, you know, what kind of help the schools need, if any.
Mm-hmm.
I thought our HR mm-hmm. function was working pretty well. I've actually been in touch with the two folks that will do the union contracts. One of them is labor council, one of them is our former HR person. We decided she did some work for the schools, and then we've run into some TLT budget issues. So I asked her to wait till July. I think we'll pick that up in the new fiscal year with the objective of being done by November, December. The point is that labor council has never looked at our collective bargaining contracts in the history of Reading. It's probably not the best idea.
Okay.
He's given us individual advice, but he's never looked at a contract in full and said, oh, look at that, it's not legal, or it is,
mm-hmm.
or what's the best practice.
Well, and we've learned since we've hired Ray. The folly of that approach.
And we've had good labor council, the same one since I've been here, so I'm not as worried about that, but I'm worried that it was only us asking questions of a piece, and the piece says, oh yeah, this is good. He never saw the whole thing.
So don't we have that reviewed before we sign it?
Not by a lawyer. That's
How's
the point.
That? That's a pretty interesting.
No, we're very frugal. And
to the unions?
To the credit of the unions, most of the unions do not use a lawyer.
or they may run it by, you know, some lawyer, but they don't sit in on the bargaining. Schools, there's lawyers on both sides all the time. So, you know, it's a more collaborative approach, but Carol Roberts is the perfect person to do it because she sat in for years and knows the intention and the history of a lot of the language. So, I don't expect anything to come of it that's a problem, but it would be awfully nice to just feel like, you know, labor council's vetted it and maybe reorganized a little. I reorganized one of the contracts on a weekend once, the fire one. It just made no sense to me with the logic that it was, and I just got mad one weekend, so I just redid the whole thing, and I thought they were just going to throw it out, but they liked it. So, we'll fix that.
Before you jump away from that selectman's policy, I just want to kind of say out loud, because it's on my mind, is that I'm suspecting there is no such policy for what I'm going to talk about, but I think we should consider it, and maybe in the absence of the policy, just kind of maybe agree together to think about this. And that is, more and more often, we're hearing from various advisory committees who have an interest in producing their own flyer, their own printed material. And, you know, we work as liaisons, and you know, we all have a handful of these. And I think in general, we have allowed each other to just kind of guide and counsel them. And I think we could end up with a lot of inconsistency, especially as more of this surfaces. I think all of that ought to find its way right through Bob and or Matt rather than through us. I don't know. How do you guys feel about that?
It's going to be a lot more consistency if it runs through the town side, the daytime government.
Yeah, that's our motto. More daytime government involvement, less nighttime for the people.
Well, I just think from a consistency standpoint, I mean, it's not that we would act nefariously or, you know, in a rogue way, but I just think it's really important when the town is speaking through one of the advisory committees that we have a certain quality control to it.
Or even to say it more differently, that the town will speak through advisory committees when the town elects to speak through advisory committees.
Exactly.
And not before.
And if you have the same, I mean, we've got an ombudsman for a reason.
That makes sense.
And that person also, you know, fortunately for us, happens to be a licensed attorney. I mean, that we should be using that, is what I'm saying. So, I don't think we have a policy for this, guys.
I was just looking. No, you don't. But unless it's tucked
into this. I would just
suggest
that until such time as we revisit all the policies.
It's between the lines, but it's not explicit.
I think we should, unless somebody has an opposition to it.
Well, that's going to be even more important with more associate members who have their own view of what a group might do or come in and out based on whether there's a permanent member present.
It's also much easier to communicate with the public with social media now than it was 25
right.
years
so you can
ago.
Do much more havoc than you used to be able to do.
And that doesn't mean you can't say or speak. What it means is when you're speaking as an advisory committee to the selectmen, I think there should be some management to the quality control of how it's dispensed.
If you're speaking with the imprimatur of the town, it's got to come through the town before you speak.
That's what I think.
Well, and some of you are keenly aware that you know, free speech is not free when you're a volunteer.
Right.
It just isn't.
Yep.
Most volunteers. So, yeah, no, it's not addressed. I just checked. Certainly could do that.
So that'd be I'd like
to add that to
draft.
The list.
Okay.
I think that needs to be on the list.
Right.
And, you know.
It makes sense.
And even if it's not on the list now, from a straight practical point of view, that's the expectation.
I intend to bring back to us when it's not this hour and we're not fully packed, that we consider that as something we kind of agree among ourselves. So I think we can move on. I don't mean to distract us too much.
Did you say fully gassed?
I did not.
Okay.
I'm not clear if gassed is a good thing or a bad thing.
Are they still open?
I think so. There's other places down there that already have a license.
True.
We're all done with technology. We've made all the decisions we need to make. Public meetings are done for now, although I think there's gonna be another couple of them suggested to you, probably in August. You know, the September 1st is the next public meeting to discuss finances. That's too much of a gap. You know, we heard some things at each meeting. We heard some things and tried to adapt. And the third one, we heard some more things. And you know, we need to sit down as staff and then maybe involve one or two of you and try to decide what's the next public meeting. And I'll give you an example. I don't know if it's really worth it, but both John and I heard from at least some people, you need to show me all the things you've done over the last, you tell me how long, 3 years, to make this necessary. You know, anyone involved in the budget process at town meeting is probably bored to death of that, but
yep.
it's a fair comment. A lot of people have not been involved in that. And I have to tell you, of any of the issues I've ever been involved with for the last 20 years in Reading, more people that I don't know have come up to me and talked to me about this in the last month and a half, saying, you know, first of all, they enjoyed the presentation. They had no idea most of the facts, and now they have some kind of basis to understand things. And most of them were referred by a friend who went to the first one or heard about it, or a volunteer who was already involved in local government. So it is important to try to reach
out. And there
out.
Was applause at the end of at least two of them.
Oh, really?
Yeah, there was.
They were glad it was done.
I think
well, that could be.
You know, a lot of feedback I've gotten in that regard is, you know, people want to know if we were going to propose one, what's the number?
Right.
You know,
right.
I think that's the basic thing. What does it look like in my wallet?
I say we're 90% done because I think that's the last 10% is how much and
yep.
what does it do?
Yeah. And I
yeah,
think you have to have.
What are we spending on?
I think it's important probably to have that discussion prior to us needing to take a vote on.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
On doing it. So
is that. I mean, do we have that on our agenda?
You have in July, and I still don't know which meeting the Board of Assessors want to talk to you about that senior tax relief.
Right.
I'll just say.
Okay. Oh, right. I think,
so
I think we need to
meeting.
Spend the summer with a piece of this
yeah.
as part of every agenda.
Yeah.
We got to be ready, and we have to be simple. You know, when it's time to come up with, if and when a decision is made for an override, there's got to be a certain simplicity to people being able to understand what we're trying to do. Okay.
Good show.
So
that's it on the goals. Next one or two meetings, I'm not sure. we're almost through our personnel evaluations for the year, and that's where we start discussing future year goals.
Mm-hmm.
And I will tell you, the list has never been shorter than it is right now. It's
yeah.
like survive.
Yeah.
yeah.
Well,
it's because they stopped asking.
Well, I will observe that at the staff level, I've never seen really dedicated people more exhausted. And, you know, that's not a good thing. And I don't mean to complain, it's just I'm stating a fact.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
it's troubling. And I don't know why, because I don't think the workload today is much different than 6 months ago. It's just the cumulative effect of a long period of time.
It's just, that's what I was going to say, it's extended. It's not,
yeah.
it's,
and every
it hasn't been in quick bursts. It's
right.
been
every
elevating.
Every fiscal year, it's a little heightened. You know, you got to make sure everything's perfect, because after the end of the year, you can't change it. And, you know, myself and others have found more simple, small mistakes that have been made in the last year that you have to catch up to. It's not a big deal than I've ever seen.
It's a cumulative effect.
And to me, that's a telling thing. It's like, you know, people around here used to be perfect. They're not anymore. They're well above average. But they're just making this much mistakes because they don't have the time to check their work.
The bandwidth is being stretched
yeah.
enormously. And it's clear.
Yeah.
People who are always who have been for years extremely helpful continue to be helpful, but don't have quite as much space to fit it all in.
Yeah.
So, are you done with the goals, Bob?
I am. Thank you.
So, I have one last item before we close, and you'll see it on your agenda, and it has to do with the fact that in all the activity of listening sessions and everything that's been going on among us over the course of the last 6 weeks, we find ourselves soon to have no contracted town manager a few days from now. And we're going to keep him on a very short leash.
Was,
so,
was he not telling us that on purpose, maybe?
I think so.
Like
I said,
head?
Bob, isn't it a contract time? And he went, oh, well, that silly thing. You're not running and hiding. So I asked Ray if he would prepare something,
yep.
Which he has done, which
Bob has had a chance to look at, and I have too, and it's more just a courtesy extension of 30 days.
When does the contract expire?
June 30th.
June 30th.
June 30th, 11:59 p.m.
Oh,
yeah, but who's counting? Of course. So what I've asked Gray to do is put together something that's suitable. I mean, really, it's just an extension of what's going on for 30 days. Gives us the time to finalize. Because you'll remember, some of the things that are changing for Bob's contract have to do with his full-time status.
Correct.
You know, I mean, his 37.5 hours goes to 40 hours, which is about half of the amount of hours that he spends working on behalf of all of us. And anybody that knows him knows that to be true. So this is more of an alert to you that we needed to extend the contract. And
so it looks like it's just 30 days?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's a 30-day.
Is that enough time?
It is. Bob and I will, you know, get it together and then get it back to you.
John did mention a series of 31-day contracts. Might be the best way to keep control of me.
It's like the Cromnibus.
Yeah. Well, no, it's like the famous manager of the Brooklyn Dodgers, and then Walter Austin. 27 one-year contracts.
Yeah.
They offered him more.
Prove your worth.
Would never take them. And you know,
until one day they didn't.
Right.
It was a new owner, I think, that caused that to happen. So that's a heads up for you,
right?
That's there, and it's just really a extension of 30 days.
So there's a motion.
There is.
Move to approve the amendment of the May 21st, 2013 employment agreement between Town of Reading and Robert Lasher for services as town manager as presented.
Second.
Discussion?
I just want to bring up one thing that I think it's important that you have a new town council that looks at the agreement. You know, this was another town council that did it.
Yeah.
So I sent him an email and made him
aware
then that he should direct his comments to John and to Sharon. Mm-hmm. Not to me.
Which he did.
Okay.
Which is the right protocol. I mean, you know, this is yet one more thing. There's a lot of little cleanups. You know, a lot of little,
legacy,
you know, things that need to be.
Were there material findings, John, or were they just stuff around the corner?
Not material, but there was some cleanup he had to do on it.
Okay.
I could put them side by side, but, and Bob, I think you probably would notice it when you look at it, but.
I'll let you know.
Yeah, I think I would have heard. I noticed it got to the agenda, so I'm assuming that it was fine, but just little things like the protocol of who should be getting it.
Yeah. So would you characterize most of the changes as housekeeping then?
Yes.
And legal?
In keeping with what Ray has been doing for us now for at least a couple of years, or maybe longer now, every time he gets a look at something, there's a little.
It costs us money.
He's actually pretty good about that.
I was just going to say, the other day I sent something, a contract. It was a formal letter we're sending to the contractor for the library project, to their contract expert, and I expected to get a lot of red crosses. She calls me back and she says, asked me two questions. She said, is that what you meant to accomplish? She said, yes. She said, exactly as it is, it's fine.
That's right.
Really?
Yeah.
She said, no. I there's no reason. There's no reason for me to micromanage this. You've made all your points. So they're pretty good, actually. And what that tells me is when they're correcting things, they need correcting.
If I was hiring a personal law firm, I would be inclined to hire them.
Yeah.
We are so
for all the reasons we're talking about here.
We're so lucky we picked these guys.
Yep.
Yeah. It was a good
choice.
It picked us too. That was nice.
Yeah, I just want to say it's been 3 years, and it's hard to believe because it's a blink of an eye in one form or another, and on the other hand, there's a lot that's gotten done. It feels like 10 years.
In a good way.
Time flies when you're having a good time, right?
Exactly.
No, you have 10 year.
Yeah, okay. Right. That's true. Well, thank you.
Ready for the vote?
And yes, I'm ready for the vote. All those in favor?
Okay.
And I am perfectly happy deferring the minutes because I had some comments which I didn't get done. So.
Okay, then we'll defer the minutes.
Defer the minutes. All right.
Move that the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at
10:34.
Yeah.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. You want a good yuck? Read the back of this.
Yeah.
I saw you chuckling, and I did.
Oh, yes. I included an anonymous.
So we're getting called out for not.
This was not signed. This is not the person's name.
Well, no. Why would you sign that?
So, Bob.
Yeah. The board members are not worth the necessary salary.
Not for nothing. You get a brand new clock and it's wrong, just like the other one? I mean, what's that all about?
It is.
You gotta get the facilities director.
Well, that came, this came in today. Yesterday.
I only noticed that a couple days ago. I have no idea when it changed.
Oh, well.
Where'd that go?
Oy, oh.
This is incredible, this letter.
Oh, it's great.
You know, when people don't put their name, you know.
Oh, it's telling.
Yeah, I have to admit, I would respect it a lot more if I knew who it was.
Right.
And I could have a conversation with them if
no,
they want.
No, 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 that's a one-way conversation.
Water producing facility.
That's an argument that's not open for debate.
Yeah.
For that person.
Yeah, well, you never know. You're probably right.
It's probably Tom Ryan.
No, he would've signed.
No, it's definitely somebody.
Time would say.
His spelling would've been better.
It's definitely on Summer Street.
Yes, it would've.
This is this is fabulous.
Someone in that neighborhood.
This is a great letter.
They already called us out on our salaries, don't they?
Yeah. My gosh. I'll give mine back.
I know that, really.
I feel chagrined. I think I'll do the same.
I just lost a deal while I'm sitting here, so.
Thank you.
Hi, Caitlin, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Caitlin. Good night.
If you and your cronies had any brains, which is doubtful, you would resign.
I love the cronies.
So,
there is
so now if you and your cronies have any brains, which is doubtful. Oh my God, this is fabulous.
Is this the guy that was stuck at North Reading that did a mile and a quarter?
Oh, maybe.
Spun his car.
Yeah.
Is that guy?
This, I didn't even get to this. This is wonderful.
I look, all of a sudden, I look over and Dan's chuckling. I see what he's chuckling at.
Look carefully, guys, because there's a bunch of one pages here. They're not labeled with the red tabs.
Okay.
So look carefully.
So good.
Oh, all right.
I can't wait to get this one home.
I just, you know, people hide behind the anonymous stuff. It's just gullible.
Well, that's what makes the website so dangerous when you have comments.
Yeah.
Because people have license to just talk until they.
Peter Heckenblecker and I had a lot of talk about that. I said, Pete,
you don't
mind having two-way,
right.
But you can't have anonymous.
No.
You just look at Patch and all
because
the other
stuff.
Because
you're going to feel obliged to respond. You're not going to really know who.
Oh, that's just the worst mistake you can make.
Idea.
All you need to
do
is
engage
with
them.
Engagement is awful.
There's a bunch of one-pagers.
Did that come in via email or did that come in via
US
mail?
US mail. Well,
did it have a return address?
No, it did not.
That's a Barry only.
It was just completely like a stamp and that's
it. It was a gutless coward.
We didn't fingerprint it.
One at a time because I think it's just a sign in just about every page. Except for one or two of the Barry signs.
Oh, those are minutes.
It's all kinds of stuff here.
Yeah.
So like the license.
All right, gentlemen.
Hang in there. When are we meeting
again?
Your
next meeting is July 12th. Right now,
oh.
If the assessors cannot meet, you actually don't have any agenda items. So I'll think about that and talk to John and figure it out. I don't really think you should not meet, but.
Holy cow.
Maybe start.
Going to split tonight with that?
Yeah.
No, all this.
Jeez.
Most of this had to happen tonight.
Yes, you're right.
Mark Scala's stuff didn't happen.
That's
was first
true.
On the list.
That turned into more than I thought it was going to be. I mean,
yeah.
Yeah, people come in and talk.
I didn't want to say too much more, but you just throw
when the chair talks for a full hour.
take the tree lawn back.
You open it up.
I think we need to throw it at the rec department and get that field out of it. This seems like
I agree.
Anything
you're
going to
get a lot of kickback on that. You don't just take fields away. It's being used.
Well, let me tell you. I mean,
we
just
to
took.
Don't they have an agreement to maintain that? I mean, we don't have to use it.
We just took away a lot of fields when we shut those. Shut that light project down.
Are we up here? You should be.
probably not.
I would say don't count on that.
No, I think it's worth looking at.
Will get the message. John,
what's the stick up with Memorial Park? So it seems to be a lot of space over there. Is that not?
Oh, there's all kinds of issues.
You got a walking thing over there?
You have a deed problem.
It's restricted to the deed.
You have a deep problem.
Passive recreation. Sort.
It depends on how you define passive recreation.
Yeah, but it was that was
how
run
long
up,
ago
that was
that?
Run up the flagpole.
Not
the
long.
Smackdown.
Not long ago.
Yeah.
Within the last 10 years.
Yeah, exactly. It's
not even that. It was shorter than that.
I think you're right.
And what was the reason for deed restricting it?
Well, it was restricted by.
It was restricted for years.
For
it was restricted from its original deeding.
Okay, that's my point.
The interpretation might be reasonable.
Well, the guy went to court, and as soon as he won, he moved away.
But
Rick Carter's mother's house across the street.
Things should always be relooked at.
What's the
no
organized
baseball playing?
Never should ever be a
tobacco.
Word that we use.
What's the date? 21.
Yeah. Never should ever be a word
today,
we use. That's what the restriction say, never.
It's 20.
Word that drives me.
Oh, this was.
This was an attorney in the old days, so.
All right, gentlemen.
You see, Barry signs this one alone.